Father God, we praise your holy name. Father, we just thank you. We love you, Jesus. We praise you, Jesus. We praise you, Father. Father, we thank you. Father, we thank you for everything, everything that you have blessed us with in our lives, the things that we take for granted, our pets, our families, in many cases, even with the strife that comes with a lot of times, Father. We praise you for every bite of food, every drink of water, every day that we have work that we can go to, the earnings that we make, the ability to be able to seed and to put tithes into the kingdom and to help feed the poor and touch other people's lives. We praise you, Father God, for our working automobiles. Father, we ask you in Jesus' name for an outpouring of your holy power and a holy fire and a hedge of protection around all the elements of our life, our walk. We pray in the name of the Lord Jesus, Father God, that you will build a hedge of protection. We declare it in the name of Jesus, a holy fire around our families, around our loved ones, around our households, around our pets, around our appliances, around our computers, around every shingle and every nail of our house, every bough of every tree, in the name of Jesus. We consecrate it into your complete ownership, Lord Jesus. We consecrate every breath that we take, every beat of our heart into your complete ownership, Lord Jesus. We surrender all to you. We ask you, Father, in the name of Jesus, to save the souls of our loved ones, to save the souls of our sons, save the souls of our daughters, save the souls of our sisters and our brothers and those who are close to us. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that you will fortify our walk, that you will fill us with an abundant grace and touch us with your living water, filling us, Father God, with a supernatural strength and a peace which passes all understanding, placed upon our heart and our mind through Christ Jesus. Help us, Father, to see the glory that you have laid before us by choosing us before the foundations of the world for a time such as this which we live in right now. Give us the patience of Job, Father God, and help us to understand that you, Father, our Lord, giveth and you taketh away. We pray in Jesus' name that you will give us that patience, give us that strength, and help us to see the blessings that are a part of our everyday walk, that we can sing praises to you no matter how much it rains, for it rains on the just and the unjust, and how much the sun shines. We thank you, Father God, for all of your blessings. We praise you, Father God, and let our praise never be diminished or leave our lips. Let us wake up in the morning and sing praises and glory to you, Father, for everything that we see and everything that we don't see, all the things that you have chosen us to become and all the things that we wish to become. We praise you, Father God, for our eternity. We thank you, Father God, for the heavenly rewards, for we know the thoughts of, because Father, we know that you don't think evil thoughts about us, but thoughts of good to bring us to an expected end, and that you are doing everything, Father God, everything to touch our lives, to raise your holy and righteous hand above us, to guide our paths. For the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, though he falls, he will not be utterly cast down, for you uphold him with your righteous and holy right hand. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that you will give us that supernatural power to be able to continue walking when we stumble. We praise you, Father God. Let not these words, Father, be hindered by our behaviors. We pray that you will raise up before each and every one of us behaviors in our hearts, feelings in our hearts, things that we feel, things that we say that maybe we shouldn't ought. We pray in the name of Jesus, Father, that you will create in each of us a clean heart, O Lord. Cleanse us, Father God, with your hyssop. Make us whiter than snow. We pray in the name of Jesus for the outpouring of your Holy Spirit in each of our lives. We ask you, Father, explicitly for the Holy Spirit gift of love, the Holy Spirit gift of faith, the Holy Spirit gift of discerning of spirits. In the name of Jesus, the Holy Spirit gift of a word of knowledge that we can bless other people, and the Holy Spirit gift of wisdom. We also want the Holy Spirit gift of miracles and healing, Father God, in the name of Jesus, to come upon our lives that we can change the lives of others. But Father, more than anything, we ask you for a spirit of boldness to fall upon each of our lives, that we cannot stand to walk past one person that we see hurting, one person that we feel in our spirit is an opportunity for us to reach out and touch with the eternal love of our Lord Jesus Christ. Make the love, Father God, in each of us overflow. Raise it up, Father God. Amplify it within each of our walks so that we move upon people, that we touch people, that we give them hugs in public, that they know that Jesus is coming and that Jesus loves them more than anything else. Oh, Father, we need to have that. We need to have that overflowing love, that feeling, that boldness, that strength to be able to touch and change people's lives with a smile and a kind heart that through the empathy of our King Jesus through us can help to bring them to a knowing of our Lord. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus for that holy hedge of protection to surround all of us, to surround our loved ones, for that holy fire to surround their families. Father, we ask you to protect us against each and every one of the threat vectors in our lives. Father, in the name of Jesus, we cancel the assignments of the demons of death. We cancel the assignments of the spiritual host of wickedness and rulers of darkness in high places. We cancel the assignments against the demons, the unclean spirits that would do us ill, the witches, warlocks, wizards, and anything that would do us ill, Father God, that would come against us. We break all yokes of bondage in Jesus' name. We cast them out. We cast the darkness out of our lives, and we declare the holy fire and a whirlwind of the Holy Spirit around it to blow it white hot, to sustain it, Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, that we may continue the works of the kingdom, that we are full of salt and light, and that we appreciate the respite, that we appreciate the period of time that we have now. Because, Father, quite frankly, I don't think most of us realize how dark it's going to get. I don't think most of us realize the impact that the darkness is going to have on each of us. And while, Father, we believe in our hearts that you are going to outpour your Holy Spirit and give us a supernatural strength to make it through the darkness, that we can touch people's lives, we know that that is inevitable, but we don't know how soon. And we walk in faith. We praise your holy name. And we thank you, Father, for helping us to see the blessings associated with what it seems to many of us as being a delay. But that's because we don't see the beginning from the end as you do. Thank you, Father, for helping us through your word and through your servants, the prophets, to understand a good portion of the kingdom dynamics that are in play today, that we can finish this race by maintaining a steady course of wisdom and love overflowing. In Jesus' name, we all pray and thank you, Father. Amen. Praise Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Yeah, Jose is with us tonight. Praise God. Hey, Jose, are you there?
Brother, I'm right here.
See, that's not virtual Jose, everybody. Hey, say, Jose, say to everybody, 1, 2, 3, 4.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Okay. So you see, I had to prove to everybody that it's the real Jose because I had virtual Jose, you know, on the earlier show. Praise God. Everybody's happy you're here, bro. Everybody's happy you're here, bro. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah, Jose and I were just having a conversation before the show about the duplicitous. This is a conversation that I've had with, you know, prior folks on prior shows, many, many hundreds of shows ago. You know, back when we thought the rapture was going to happen every 2 weeks, you know. Oh, well, if it didn't happen this Sunday, it's going to be, okay, 14 more days, money. That'll be the, you know, wait a minute, what feast, you know, Shavuot, it could be Omer 1, Omer 2, Omer 3, Omer 4, no, it might be Omer 5. Wait a minute, when's the next Jewish holiday? Wait, that could be the rapture. Wait, there's a meteor coming, wait a minute, we've got a solar eclipse thing happening on Friday. Now, granted, only people in New Zealand can see it, but that's okay. That's going to be when the rapture comes. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. That's how I used to be. I used to drive myself crazy. There were times when I would lose sleep. I'd be like, oh, I was so excited. I was like, oh, there's too many people, you know, too many people that I trusted and I loved. And, you know, we're all in this together, folks. You know, why wouldn't we get excited? I mean, one of the things that Jose and I were talking about is the, for lack of a better term, the duplicitous nature of how we are to behave in our walk as we run the race. When Paul used the, metaphor or whatever of running a race, it was like, couldn't have been more inspired. Because anybody who knows anything about long distance running, and especially if you dabbled in it a little bit, or if you were on a track and field or whatever team, you know, in high school or whatnot, then you know that pacing yourself is absolutely imperative. It's not optional. If you don't pace yourself, then you fail. You just fail. You will not finish the race if you don't pace yourself. And that requires, you know, having, you know, maybe periods of bursty running, maybe having slowdown periods where you're running a little bit, you know, you're just kind of taking it easy and you gotta find that happy medium. I don't know what that is for each believer. I think each believer has even Jesus would break away from the quote multitudes and go up and pray. He'd get away, go up into the mountains or whatever and spend time alone with the Lord. And, you know, we all have to find that way to run the race, because each of us has a different level of tolerance for the roller coaster ride associated with whether I'm just going to be now, you know, because, and it just depends. Here's the thing. There are people out there that are just steady as she goes personalities. And then there are people that are, we're all different. We all dance to, you know, like they say, dance to different drummers, different, you know, and it's true. We all have different personality types. Some people are more overtly passionate and tend to have roller coaster rides. You know, oh boy, you know, I remember I worked at a company back in the 80s where two of the company owners were talking intentionally in front of me so that they could hear. And one of them even said to me in the hearing of the owner of the company, Mr. Braswell, John, you know, if you don't get a grip over your emotions, you're going to fail in business. That was basically what he said. And he was right. I knew it. I did, you know, from the business standpoint, over the years, I conditioned and trained myself to, you know, maintain a straight face when people were dropping F-bombs on the phone and calling me incompetent and humiliating me in front of a half a dozen people on a conference call. I had to, you know, remain cool, calm, and collected. You can't react when you're dealing with a billion-dollar, multi-billion-dollar global company, right? Amen? So, but you've got to be able to run the race a long, long way. Maybe the race is a long race. Maybe the race is going to be longer than we think it is going to be. Maybe it's not going to be 2019, or maybe it's going to be sooner. We don't know. But we have to prepare ourselves. We've got Bible scripture that makes it very clear. 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, where Paul's, you know, admonishing the behaviors of the Thessalonians and saying, look, you know, you don't work, you don't eat. That whole thing was about, you know, the whole second letter to the Church of Thessalonica was because they were freaking out. Like we are. They're freaking out. You know, granted, I'm sure that in amidst that church congregation, there were probably people that were relatively level-headed. But there were enough of them that got so excited they didn't bother to maintain their resumes and keep their job. You know, one of them let the part about, you know, being a really good vine dresser slip off the end of the resume or whatever. I'm quipping. But the point is, we got to maintain. So while we're excited, while we keep our mind stayed on things above and not on this world, while we do not, you know, while we are not adulterers and adulteresses and putting, you know, and being in love with the earth and enmity with God, and we're absolutely citizens of heaven and absolutely obsessed with our Father. We love the Lord our God with all our heart, all our mind, all our soul. We are totally obsessed with all things of the kingdom. We are absolutely gushing and overflowing with love of Jesus. We are absolutely gushing because of that, overflowing and gushing with the love of our neighbor, which really is pretty much everybody around us, the people that we want to make our brothers and sisters ultimately, and our brothers and sisters too, in Christ. See, but we got to, there's a duplicitous paradox associated with the existence. Do you fix your roof or not? Yup. But Father, I would rather seed that money into the kingdom. Amen. What you going to do? Got to do both. Got to fix the roof. Got to seed money into the kingdom. Got to do both. Can't stop. We can't stop doing what we got to do. We can't stop keeping up our resume. We can't stop going and getting training for our professions and getting more nebulous letters after our name so that we can stay competitive in the industry. We need the people that were part of the original churches back when the apostles were walking around on the earth. They worked for the purpose. They wanted to have jobs. They wanted to be employed, of course, because they wanted not to be they wanted to be givers. They wanted to be able to seed into the kingdom, to give into the kingdom, to help other people, to do good things. So should we all. But at the same time, they also didn't want to be, unless they were going through hard times or chastening or whatever, who wants to be a burden upon other brothers and sisters, right? Nobody does. But we all fall on hard times. We all go through difficult times. And that's why the early church in Acts 2, sold everything they had and gave to each one according to their need. And for lack of a better term, folks, they were known as, by everybody around them, as the way. They were known as a cult. They behaved like people living on a commune, really. And that continued, that behavior, the early church continued, the Paulines, the Waldensians, the Albigensians, which I can't say right, I always dork it up, but all these different, the Bogomils, all of them. They set up communities just like the Amish do today. They set up, communities. They built houses and groups and areas, and they all hung out together. They had church together. They loved upon each other. They helped one another, very much like the Amish do today. The Amish are just amazing. The only thing they're really lacking in their community is the baptism of the Holy Spirit for the most part. And then when they do receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, they go out and start churches that are immensely successful. Praise Jesus. But because God, boy, talk about the Lord. The Lord, will – A lot of people struggle and don't receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. One of the fastest way to get the baptism of the Holy Spirit, if you're seeking the Father, is make sure you are pure and pray for purification all the time. Make sure you have all the sin out of your life. You need to be pure, white as snow, because God, you're far more likely to receive the full-blown baptism of the Holy Spirit, speak in tongues, and gifts, the wonderful gifts in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. But anyway, 1 Corinthians chapter 12. But anyway, we have to be able to run the race, but we also have to surrender ourselves to the fact that we've got to live this duplicitous, paradoxical, for lack of a better term, lifestyle. We've got to fix the roof. We've got to keep up our resume. We've got to go to college if that's what's required. I got a lot of emails from people. My mom and dad want me to go to college, and I think Jesus is coming. And I'm like, go to college, son. Just go to college. Folks, you don't know. I have been through the ringer on all of this stuff. The Lord has blessed me with the one thing that, and then you say to yourself, well, one of the things that really makes this walk hard for us, for people that, I'm not just saying people that, are listening to this radio show, but certainly if you're listening to this radio show, I would submit that you have been bombarded with information that makes it exceedingly difficult to do the mundane earthly things that we have to do to continue to feed our families, etc., right? We've been exposed and blessed by having so many guests that have been taken to heaven, people who have had visions of heaven, we're familiar with many of the books of people who wrote. Many of us have read those books of people who have been taken to heaven and been there. I'm going to do in a couple of weeks, I have a Wednesday night set aside to do a review of the Odin Hetrick testimony, which is just, oh man, it's like the best. And when you get it, see, how much harder is it then to like, oh gosh, oh no, the alarm clock is going off. I mean, it's like, because you know how awesome heaven is. You know how awesome it is. You especially don't want to be here then. When you really, really, really get it, when you truly fall in love with the Father, when you truly fall in love with Jesus, when you realize that Jesus isn't just the Jesus that you heard about in the Gospels, but Jesus is like, the creator of creation. I mean, read John 1:1-5, as a matter of fact, I think I have it here. I don't know. Let me see. Maybe I can cue it up. I love it. It's just so awesome. Yeah. Check this out.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him nothing was made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it.
Okay, take that and map it across, trillions of galaxies, right? Possibly as many parallel universes, as many dimensions. Because remember, dimensions are like so you have like a universe, right? this is just my perception of it. I don't know. Maybe I have a pretty good perception. Maybe I don't. Maybe I got it dorked up and I'll have to, you know, get a, you know, thunky thunkenheimer upside my head. No, you had it almost right. Whack, you know. But you had the most important part wrong. Who knows? If anyone thinks they know anything, they know nothing yet as they ought to know. 1 Corinthians 8:2. But if my understanding is correct, you've got, you know, this time space, this universe, okay, right? And then you've got dimensions and realms that overlay it, right, that we can't see. So we're always told that the things that are unseen are more real than the things that are seen. So that implies kind of like almost like a layered hologram of particle existences, different realms, and we can't see them because, you know, our eyes can't focus, we can't see. It's just like channels on a TV. Go back to the 70s when you used to be, you'd be like, Lucy! And you'd be like watching I Love Lucy, and then Dennis the Menace would overlay the channel, and you'd be like, get out of there, Dennis! And you'd run over, because of course there wasn't a remote back then, and you'd run over to the TV, and you'd start to click channel 3 and channel 4 back and forth, click, 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 trying to get Dennis Menace off of I Love Lucy. It'd just drive you crazy. And then, but anyway, that's kind of like, you know, realms and dimensions. So you've got multiple dimensions, right? And we know that through the use of particle accelerators and particle physics and such and quantum mechanics, we know that at least with our, you know, infinitesimally small level of understanding, that there's at least 11 mathematically perceivable dimensions in our time space in this particular universe, right? How many more are there that we can't measure? Okay, let's just assume that there's just 11, okay? So then you got 11 channels on the TV channel changer that are all essentially on the same TV. The TV is the universe. It's the time-space universe, the realm that we are in. And then you've got like at least another 11 channels that overlay it that we can't see, or sometimes we see a little bit. You know, oh no, there's an angel. Well, that's because it's coming in from the Dennis the Menace channel. We can see it a little bit. But they overlay one another, but they're all present in the same time space, in the same now. Multiply that against another universe, another universe, another universe, another universe. But what if there's a million of them? What if there's a million parallel universes and all of them have, oh, I don't know, 100,000 realms and dimensions that are overlaid on top of them? And don't even get me going on the super tiny itsy bitsy boy. When you take like electron microscopes and all these incredible, you know, and you get smaller and smaller and smaller. I mean, there's like entire, like, I don't know, universes of existence that exist within the realm of the incredibly small that we don't even see it. We don't even realize it. If we had any idea what all was on one of our hands, you know, before we use our, you know, Purell, we'd be like Howard Hughes. We'd be like, well, I'm not going to touch the doorknob without a hanky, you know. But it's so amazing. And then you take that word, you know, Jesus, who Jesus is, and you map that. You map that across all of creation. And then you realize that the scripture says that all of creation groans for the manifestation of the sons of God. That's us. And of course, if you're part of the bride, it stands to reason you're going to receive the greatest amount of rewards, which would certainly indicate that we would rule and reign with Jesus. What are we going to rule and reign over? You know, I don't know, animated flowers in a field in heaven? You, flower, turn to the left, turn to the right, stand up, sit down, fight, fight, fight. I don't know. We, you know, think about it. We've got to be able to get our arms around how huge this is. And when we do, when we realize that ruling and reigning certainly has something to do with all of creation, because that's essentially what the Bible says, right? And we're being raised up as a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people. Wow. When we get the scope defined, which is frankly undefinable, but at least get a touch of how big it is, now go back to your alarm clock. Oh, gee, I got to go to work. I got to fix the roof. The kids are screaming. I got to take little Chucky to soccer. You know, it's like, it's so hard. It's extra, extra hard to run the race because you have been elucidated. You have entered a new realm of maybe holy wisdom to see how awesome this all is, just let alone heaven. Heaven alone by itself, the glory of heaven, the awesomeness, the love that you feel that is just gushing from everything. Every single element of heaven is singing songs in harmony. The joy, the amazing beauty, the color spectrums that you can't see on earth that you can see 10 times more. in heaven. And, you know, the for guys like me and Jose, you know, the all-night buffets that have, like, not just food of every single country in on Earth, but probably every single quadrant of the galaxies. Jose and I are never leaving the all-night buffet, are we, Jose?
Never, sir.
No. No, you want to look. Just look for the guy with the Hawaiian shirt standing behind beside another big guy with a beard, and you will find me and Jose at the all night buffet, enjoying some Romulan Oriental noodles or something. Who knows? But when you get, you know, it's kind of like, and I was just mentioning Jose before the show. It's kind of like getting a phone call from a lawyer. You know, your phone ring, and they leave a message. Please call us back. This is Abraham Isaacson from Ichabod Isaacson Law Firm in Greece, and we have an important message for you. Call us back. And then you call them back, and they pick up the phone, and this woman answers and says, yes, we just wanted to let you know that your great aunt, Ethel Merman, she is about to pass away, and she has left you $100 million in cash and a very large 8,000-square-foot estate on 200 acres of property. All of it is paid for. There's a trust fund set up. The money is inexhaustible. You are set up for life. It is beautiful. It is gorgeous. You're going to love it. You can bring your family, kids, tutors for all your kids, everything. It's going to be awesome. And, oh, by the way, you know, really wonderful, the cars, the whole thing. Okay, and you get to, and I say, but, sir, you have to wait until Ethel passes away. And you're like, okay, no problem. And then a year goes by, and another year goes by, and your wife is like, honey, how's Ethel doing? And another year goes by, and another year goes by, and you're like, ugh. I got to go out and get another certification for my job. I got to, you know, I got to take little, you know, Spanky to the soccer match. And, you know, it's like, when am I going to get that phone call from Abraham Isaacson or whoever? You know what I'm saying? It's like, you know, it's there. You know, it's glorious. You know, it's the most amazing thing you could ever imagine in your wildest dreams. But you got to keep on going. You got to keep on going. Hey, Jose?
That's right, brother. I mean, it's you're talking to me. You're actually talking about me. It's very interesting, but like, you know, we're saying, when you're living like a heathen, right? And every day's a party. Man, you can't wait for the next day. And all of a sudden you come to the Lord, and you realize the reality of the situation. The Bible talks about realizing, you know, man, what a filth we are sometimes, and how much of a sinners we are, and realizing the hurt that we put people through. And all of a sudden you start paying attention to the things of the world and the things that you do and the things that are done unto you. And you realize, man, the Bible was right. This place is messed up. And you keep leaving and you keep getting older and you're like, I don't want to stay here anymore. I want to leave. And then when you get to that place, the Lord says, ah, you finally arrived. Now I can use you. Now I can make you a lamp unto the world, put you on a shining hill. And I always thought, you know, I was talking to the Lord about that. And the Lord said, you know, Jose, I get it. You want to leave. I get it. You want to be with me. You love me. You want to be with me. But how selfish is that? And I said, Lord, why is it selfish? And he said, well, because you now have understanding that other people don't have. And Philippians 1:21-24 explains it clearly that could ever could. And he says, this is Paul talking. For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. So he's with us. He's like, man, Johnny, Jose, God, man, I want to leave too. But on verse 22, he says, but if I leave on in this flesh, this will mean fruit from my labor. Yet what shall I choose? I cannot tell. And he's like, you know, I do want to leave, and it'll be really cool. But man, you know, I'm not really sure. And then verse 23, for I am hard pressed between the two. So if you're not there, if you're not hard pressed between living here and living in heaven, you haven't arrived. You got to get to a place when you're like, this place has nothing for me. And it, in all honesty, and I think Johnny feels the same way, there's really nothing much for us here. All institutions are corrupted. Money comes, money goes. I mean, I'm really not a handsome person, so, I mean, there goes that. I'm barely able to make a sentence. I'm not rich. I have no wealth but to speak of. I don't want to be here, but I'm pressed between staying and leaving. And so that's, Paul understood that very well. For I am hard pressed between the two, having a desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is far better. Far better. Oh, Paul, I agree with you. Yes, far better to be with Christ. Verse 24, nevertheless, to remain in the flesh is more needful for you. Folks, I want to tell you an interesting story, very short. I have a somebody that I care a lot, that I love very much. And this person was very stubborn. They, you know, they didn't want to hear about Christ. They didn't want to hear about the joy of the Lord. And I've known this person for a very long time. And I was thought, well, you know, poor thing. Little by little, without me saying much, just me loving on this person, just me being a friend, just caring for them without banging on them, without, you know, being a Bible thumper, without criticizing, condemning them, being mean or being quote-unquote little C Christian, just caring for this person. Over the years, this person has asked me questions, you know, about the faith. And wouldn't you know, a couple of weeks ago, this person asked me, hey, Jose, what is a good book about the end times? And I about flipped. I'm like, I didn't know what to say. You want to know about? Yeah, I want to know more about the end times. And Jesus is coming again. And he started talking about, like, he's read about it before, but he's confused. And I'm like, holy moly, I would have never guessed in a million years that you'd be interested in that. Let me help you. And I got him, and I bought him a book. I'm like, dude, I'll buy the book for you. And I bought him a book, and he's reading it, and he's asking questions. That's what verse 24 is talking about. Nevertheless, yes, to be with Christ is better, but nevertheless, to remain in the flesh is more needful for you. I'm making the decision to not to be upset or not to be sad about staying here. What I'm making the decision as of this, and this is very recent, I'm processing this very recently, is that I'm going to make a decision to stay here for the saving of the souls, for the work that the Holy Spirit is going to do in me, and for the work that Christ and Jesus and God is going to do through me, that I may be a worker in the field. And yes, I want to be with Christ, which is far better. But nevertheless, I'm going to stay here for this person that asked me about this, for this other person that asked me about this, to hear the criticisms, you know, with this person that thinks I'm an idiot, and hear the criticisms of the person that's idiot. But maybe one day, as it has happened to me before, maybe one day they'll change their minds and want to know more. Maybe when those spaceships arrive and they're going to be like, I'll be their first phone call, and I'll be like, and well, yeah, let me tell you about Jesus. And to tell everybody about this wonderful God that I serve, this incredible, beautiful God that loves me so much that he put his son on the cross for me. And to tell them about the incredible adventure that I've had with the Holy Spirit and God. That's what I think is going to make it worthwhile. That's what Paul is saying here. And I think that's ought to be, in my case, it ought to be my response to staying a little bit longer. Nevertheless, to remain the flesh is more needful for you. Back to you, Johnny.
Yeah, amen. But it doesn't, and I know that you agree with this. We've already talked it over. But again, to add to what Jose's saying, so you overlay, it's both. So it's not just one or the other. It's kind of like both. So we stay obsessed. We stay excited. We stay pumped up. We stay. But you know what? That bleeds, probably not the best choice of word, that harmonizes into our day-to-day walk in a way that it adds to the salt, it adds to the light that we shine on people's lives, and so it's not about being like kind of like, oh yeah, you know, I'm okay. You know, when Paul was saying that, he was saying it for all the righteous reasons, but deep down inside you could tell he really didn't want to stay. And none of us really want to stay. But on the other hand, just like Jose's saying, when you see people's lives changed, it does mean something. And it will mean something in the biggest, most amazing way we could ever imagine in our wildest dreams, more hugely than we can, you know, because soon things are going to start shaking. Soon World War III is going to start. Soon. We don't know when, though. That's the thing. So we got to continue to maintain. We got to look on the bright side. We got to praise Jesus for every day that we have of normalcy, because it's going to get tough. One of the things, you know, we're talking about, we were both having some pretty serious plumbing problems. And he was like, well, what happened to you? And I was like, well, it's a long story, but my house was out of water for almost 48 hours. And I didn't get into all the details, but I, the Lord showed me what it's like to have to go out to the pool, get a bucket of water, and use it to flush, you know, your systems with. We take a lot of things for granted, and I think what's going to happen is when things get dark, really, really bad, you know, we're going to be praising God. We're going to be thanking Jesus. We're going to be singing hallelujah. It is going to change people's lives. They're going to see the light. They're going to hear the salt on our tongues. There's no doubt about it. But I don't think it's going to necessarily stop us from having to go out and get some water to, you know, flush stuff with. You know what I mean? We're going to still have some pretty hard times, you know, and to deal with. And so we need to really remember right now to be praising, and from the heart, you know, from the heart, praising our Lord and thanking Him for every day that we have of comparative normalcy, that we even, you know, have the time to get on our knees and spend with Him and just love on Him and love on the people around us, like Jose said. Because, and folks, planting of seeds, that's another thing real quick. Planting of seeds is subtle. But, you know, you might say, well, you know, I want to go out and do this, that, and the other thing, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, I want to get in somebody, I want to grab a megaphone. You know, here's the thing. Planting of seeds, usually, the Lord placed it upon my heart. The Lord just placed it, okay, just reminded me of this, that I used to, I still have it, a tagline in my email, which says, we are fishers of men. Fishermen don't bang gongs and scream to catch fish. They wisely bait their hooks and capture the imagination of the fish. So, there's also a section in the book of Dale Carnegie's How to Win Friends and Influence People that is just a must read if you want to become a good witness to Jesus Christ. If you want other people to be interested in you, you need to be interested in them first. He uses an example where he was invited to a dinner party. There's lots and lots and lots and lots of famous people there. And he went around the room from group to group and sat with different groups of people and listened and said, well, how about you? What do you do for a living? And he listened. He listened very intensely to everything that they said. The whole time he was at the dinner party, he barely said a half a dozen words. But he listened. After the dinner party was over, he was voted the most interesting person at the party. Now apply that to proselytizing. When we have the empathy of Jesus, the love of our neighbors, so much so that we care more about how they feel about things than what we want to tell them, what we think we have an obligation to tell them to save their souls, if we just spent more time loving them and listening, the subtlety of our seeds will make it into their heart. The heart has to be fertilized with the love of Christ first. So the subtlety of the seed will land upon fertile soil. Every time I go up to Pennsylvania to visit my sister, who's in her 70s, We sit and talk, and she will invariably say, "But Johnny, did you know that the aliens are fallen angels?" You see, she remembers something I told her a year prior. That's just an example, but it happens every time I go up. She repeats something else that I had said at some point. It was a seed that somehow made it into her heart that she embraced and wanted to share with me when she saw me the next time. Because she didn't remember where she heard it. And now she's reading like the Book of Giants and all this stuff. It's just amazing. She's like 72 years old. It's praise God. But that's an example of how seeds get planted. Again, it goes back to that. We are fishers of men. Fishermen don't bang gongs and scream to catch fish. They wisely bait their hooks and capture the imagination of the fish. Jose?
Brother, that is so true. And you know, I'm used to be guilty of that. You know, just go out there and, "Hey, Jesus, Jesus." And people weren't listening.
Chasing down the road. Jesus loves you. And out from like a crazy person, they're like, "Get me out of here. Get me out of here. This guy's worse than 50 Jehovah's Witnesses."
That's right. He's big. He's Latino, man. He's just kidding. I'm getting out of the room, please. What I've come to realize, Johnny, is that love is the best witness. And Jesus himself says that a lot. Back to you.
You mean you don't go to their front door and go like this? Jesus loves you. Open the door. Jesus loves you. Man, I'll tell you what. If the Jehovah's Witnesses did that to me, man, I'd be like, "All right, you dogs, you gotta stop whimpering and hiding in the corner. You gotta go by the front door and bark like real dogs." Oh, for crying out loud. Oh, praise Jesus. Oh, goodness gracious. All right, good times. All right, so anyway, let's go ahead and hit the monologue initial news section of the show right now. Praise Jesus.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please?
It's not normal.
It's just wrong.
It's not normal.
This is disturbing.
Game over.
All right, praise God. So for those of you Planet X enthusiasts out there, and how could we blame you? What an awesome subject to be immersed in. Praise Jesus. There is a special shout out to Jeff Byerly and West Coast Walter. I think it was West Coast that found this one. And it's probably on their whistleblower jeff.blogspot.com website. But anyway, it's a YouTube, and it's from some fellow that calls his channel Nick Thomas TV. Nick space Thomas space TV. And the title of the YouTube is "Extremely Large Red Nibiru Planet Caught in Texas Sunrise. Wow." And I'm going to second that. Wow. all the naysayers out there that for years have been trying, you know, pathetically rather, to debunk all the, Nibiru sightings, et cetera, or Nibiru solar system sightings, we should say, probably, because not all of them are the brown dwarf. You know, they're probably other planets that are part of the 7 to 5 planets that, you know, are part of that system. But, you know, it's not a sun dog or whatever. It's not a lens flare. You know, the guy is smart enough. See, we're all of us Planet X people that know it's the real deal. We're smart now, and so when we film things that, you know, like, "Oh, look, there's a second sun," we're smart enough nowadays to actually rotate our cameras and our, you know, and stuff, so that the naysayers can't say, "Well, that's a lens flare." It's not a lens flare. If you go out and you look up this Nick Thomas TV "Extremely Large Red Nibiru Planet Caught in Texas Sunrise. Wow." If you look that YouTube video up, oh my. And oh, by the way, it's in the show notes. It's on page 19 of the show notes. This one's a goodie. It's a keeper. All right, praise God. Of course, you know, the Google goblins will take it down, you know, pretty soon, I'm sure. They usually do. All right, praise Jesus. All right, and this one is in from the mailbag, and it's short and sweet and worth sharing. Praise Jesus. All right, here we go. Hold on, here we go. All right, praise God. And this one here is a commentary from a brother named Ken, who emailed me in regard to the monologue that I did on the last program. Praise Jesus. And anyway, he just says, I'll just read it. He says, "Hi, John. Boy, did you nail it on the 11th. I have reduced my feelings to just going through the motions with no anticipation for what's coming, just existing until some sort of event shows up. Frustrated that those around me do not want to see the current condition and even asking me to not mention things. When you said we cannot slip into being hurt about how things played out, I recognized my state. I'm glad I'm not alone. I have started to feel like just living my life out and not paying attention to life. I felt just like sighing. Thank you. You have brightened the light of hope in my life." All right. So he just needed to know that other people out there have gone through these phases of frustration that have, resulted in different, you know, emotional states. Some of us probably have been frustrated with the Lord. I know I've gone through bouts of that where I had to repent and say, "Father, I'm sorry," because I was really sorry. I mean, you know, when I was, you know, I was like, I felt like, you know, I hurt my best friend. And I thought, you know, I can't stand to even think about hurting my father or upsetting him, you know. And then we all feel like that. And anyway, long story short, Ken was blessed by that to know that there are others. We're all in this together, folks. We're all in this together. The reality is, it's one of the reasons why I won't take tithes. I don't want to set up, you know, even though Tribulation Now has been a ministry for many, many years now, the ministry part, it's not about, you know, hey, we're a church and you got to give, you know, pastor collection plate kind of thing. No. It's about an electronic gathering of people who are excited about Jesus coming and want to be prepared, want to be filled with the Holy Spirit, want to understand what heaven is like, want to understand what the harvest is going to be like, want to understand what the transformation of our bodies are going to be like, want to know that these things are going to happen to us while we're still on the earth, the 3 days of darkness that are coming. What is it all about? Where is it in the Bible? Those are the kinds of things. But you know what, along with that, Ecclesiastes 1:18 takes place, you know, and again, I've joked around about this many, many times, but there's kind of a sobering and sad reality associated with it. It's part of our life. "For in much wisdom is much grief, and he who increases knowledge increases sorrow." Now I would expect that would be amplified in the opposite when we make it to heaven, that because of what we went through and finishing the race, that our rewards would be so much more, many times of magnitude, even greater when we get to heaven. And the Lord knows, to me, it's like, you know, we're conditioned to like not, you know, want to have like big mansions here on the earth, right? So why would we hungering and thirsting for a big mansion in heaven? You know what I mean? It's a paradox. However, when it comes to, you know, ruling and reigning with Jesus, going with Jesus across, you know, millennial, you know, light years worth of galaxies and seeing the cosmos and going into other dimensions and seeing and meeting civilizations, other civilizations of life out there in the universes. Oh, man. Now, see, that's a whole different story for me. You know, you can have the mansion. I want to go with Jesus on that trip. I want to understand that stuff. And so that is part of the rewards package. Those are things that people who are disobedient Christians will not partake in. And these are the kinds of things that jump off the page in my ears when I read prophecies, dreams, visions, and such of people who have experienced those things and were told by the Lord that those are part of the heavenly rewards packages that we'll be receiving as part of our being fellow sufferers of Christ. Metakoi, that's the Greek word, metakoi, fellow sufferers with Christ. And suffering includes waking up in the morning and realizing that we're still stuck on this earth. And Jose, I want to know, once and for all, are we there yet?
Yes, sir.
No, we're not. Are we there yet?
No.
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 Are we there yet?
Are you little?
I was there.
Woohoo!
Praise God. Hallelujah. All right. And now let's go ahead and hit. The prophecies are starting to stack up, and I can never give them all justice. I can never give them enough time. There are so many of them. Praise Jesus. The Lord is keeping us on our seat, on the edge of our seat. Praise God. And I love it. I love it. You know, I will forever be excited about the times, the dark times that we're heading into. I know. I'm not going to be happy about, you know, plumbing being shut down. Folks, I got to tell you this. Now check this out. This is for real. I got to be real careful because if I disclose anything I shouldn't disclose, it could be bad, really bad, like super duper bad. Okay. So get this. I kid you not. I'm on a conference call with a client. Client is very important. He is as pretty much almost as high up as you can get without being on the board of directors. How about that? It's a multi-billion dollar global company. And we are talking about the Albert Pike letter to Giuseppe Mazzini in 1877, the fact that that World War III is being orchestrated by the darkness. This is not a believer, to the best of my understanding. We're talking about that there is no Democratic Party, there is no Republican Party, that it's all a facade, that the people that are put into government positions are placed there by, you know, what Fox News is now coming out right in front of everybody and calling the deep state. He even mentioned that he was aware of the deep underground military bases and the facilities underneath the Denver airport. I kid you not, folks. Okay. People know. People in influential high places know. And they know a lot more. Now, what we did admit, what he and I agreed with him about, did admit, is that the vast majority of people are in a state of denial. And they're like, talk to the hand. Because it upsets their worldview to accept. They hear the reality stings their ears, and they go into a denial rejection mode. But they know about it. The seed is planted. People are seeing the things that we talk about on this radio show. Now, it doesn't mean that – so when you see a relative, a friend, somebody you've talked to, and they've maybe humiliated you, rejected you, reviled you, just remember this. What you said, even if you didn't deliver it, especially in a loving manner perhaps, but what you said did have an impact. Because they see, and they hear. Even if they're in a complete rejection mode, they're like, this is never going to happen. It couldn't possibly be. It's all right. I've experienced it time and time and time again. And it doesn't matter if they're rejecting it. It doesn't matter if they're reviling you. It doesn't. None of that stuff matters, because at the end of the day, their subconscious received the message, and they cannot help but see the insanity of and the contradiction and just the stuff, like I said, like I mentioned on the prior show, how ridiculous it was that the mind control media would come out and say that, the Russians planted an article on a website in Qatar to cause the GCC, Saudi Arabia, and the other six countries to, cause this war footing situation to occur in the Middle East, that it was caused by the Russians. See, folks, people were waking up. They actually believe we're that dumb. And you know what? Unfortunately, there's enough of the population that has decidedly made their mind up. They cannot accept the possibility that things are as dark as they actually are. So they just run to the status quo, and they embrace the status quo, and they reject the obvious, even when deep down inside, to their greatest horror and chagrin, they actually sense that things are not right. And by the way, that's a euphemism. They're a lot worse than not right. Praise Jesus. Let's go ahead and do some of these prophecies. All right, this is Draw From My Strength by Glenda Lomax. And also a shout-out to Sister Hope at Call of the Bride. Thank you for the email that you sent. She sent me a very kind email that she was very blessed by my reading of the God's Healer 7 prophecies on the last program, that she just felt that the way that they were read amplified in her heart the meaning and the true sense of what they were intended to mean. I don't know, because I don't listen to myself. So thank you, Sister Hope. God bless you. Anyway, this is Glenda Lomax, Draw From My Strength. This one just came out yesterday. Praise God. My children, as my judgments fall, as your world is forever changed by the events following, draw from my strength. I have told you that you can do all things through me as I strengthen you. But you must choose to walk in my strength, not in your own. You will see tragedies you never imagined and more death than you ever dreamed. A time is coming when the number of dead will far outnumber those living as the plagues come, as judgments happen, as, quote, natural disasters take place. Remember, too, that not every tragedy or disaster you see is from me. The enemy also has a plan. His plan is to cause sudden deaths, that those who have not repented will be taken before they can. There is no way for you to be prepared for all the horrors to come. You must rely on my strength. You must know how to enter into my presence when you can bear no more, that I may comfort you. Things are progressing very quickly now, my children. Remember, I am with you in all things. You never walk alone. Hold on to your faith, though you will be greatly persecuted for it. Know in your heart what you believe and why you believe in me. Stir up your remembrance of our times together and all the times I have been there for you. Folks, I'm going to inject this thought. Start writing a journal. Get yourself a copy of OneNote for your phones and things and for your desktop. It's cheap or free. Keep notes. Make a journal. Stir up your remembrance of our times together and all the times I have been there for you. for these will help you endure what is to come or what is coming. Pray without ceasing for the unsaved, for time is very short now, and their eternity is at stake. Spend time with me often, that you may know me, that we may walk this final path together. All Scripture is about to be fulfilled. Praise God. Jose?
Brother, the prophets say and talk and give us these prophecies for a reason. And it's amazing that a lot of people say, well, you know, maybe, maybe not, who knows? Well, no, not really. God does nothing before talking to the prophets. And what is interesting about all these prophecies is that they're consistent. We have yet to find a prophecy saying, oh, don't worry about it. You know, just go back to what you were doing. No big deal. You know, I've postponed the apocalypse. I hear no such prophecy. The only thing I keep hearing is prepare, sanctify, prepare. I'm coming. It's going to be worse. It's going to be horrible. I'm coming. And it's there for a reason. God is being merciful. God's being graceful. God's being loving. God is being kind by giving us this heads up to his beloved prophets. Because he's, folks, nobody wants to be a prophet. I mean, if you really, really want to be a prophet, you don't really, really understand what a prophet is. Prophet means they're going to hate you because nobody likes to hear bad news. And so when you have a prophet that says publicly, hey, Lord told me to tell you it's going to be really ugly, you can believe that that prophet is getting a lot of flack for that. They're not being popular by saying such things. They're probably being ridiculed in the public. They're probably being maltreated, ill-spoken of. And that's the sacrifice they're making to fulfill God's word, to fulfill God's requirements and requests that they warn us, that God warns us through them. And so there's a reason for that. We ought to take them, you know, at the word. We ought to think and meditate and pray about these prophecies because they're consistent. They keep saying almost the same thing in different words every time. So let's stay together. Let's be prayed up. Let's get ready. And let's listen to what God has to say to our beloved prophets. Amen. Back to you, Johnny.
Amen. And never forget the Heidi Baker vision. I got it right this time, Heidi Baker. You know, because it comes suddenly. Everything changes like pow. And, you know, we don't know when. And we don't know what either, whatever that is. A lot of people speculate, but the bottom line is we don't know. And we're just going to have to watch. We got a big list of possibilities, but we don't absolutely know what the big event is that's going to change everything. And is it cosmic? Is it earthly? Is it nuclear? Is it, you know, we don't know. We're going to have to watch. Watch and wait. But once it happens, guess what? That ark door is going to slam shut, and all these people that are out there praying are not going to be heard by the Father anymore because they were living in unrighteous lives by choice. This is what's captured in Proverbs chapter 1, verses 23 to 30, 31, 32. Read it. Anyway, this is from Julie Wedby at Behold I Come. Listen to this. Prepare to meet your bridegroom. See, I love these. But I also have to, you know, not let myself get too excited because, you know, got to repair that roof. Prepare to meet your bridegroom. Yeah, you're near the final stage of this journey, amen, into intimacy with your Father. Oh, I can't wait to see. I want to be in the throne room. Many ask, how much longer until our union? Hear me. Hear me this day. Your mikvah is coming to an end, and I am doing the final work in you, my empty vessels, so my glory can pour forth in you and through you. I have stripped you, and I have tested you by fire. You are in the final molding that is specifically tailored to your individual purpose in me. Anticipate my holy fire to completely infuse you. For as I have promised, so will I do this that I have spoken. The fear of the only living God will be seen through my bride, and I will perform many miracles, signs, and wonders through you. then I will come for you. Prepare to meet your bridegroom, for surely your spirits know the nearness of my return, Yahushua, your bridegroom. And she makes a subnote. She says, in the above-mentioned word mikvah, Father is referring to the purification / cleansing that takes place before the wedding of the bride and groom in the Jewish tradition. Praise Jesus. Hallelujah. That's awesome. All right, a couple of more. There's just so many of them. Praise God. It is about to begin. This is from Glenda Lomax again. Wings of Prophecy, just praise him. It is all about to begin. You live in a time of great urgency now, my people. Even seconds will count in this time when I speak to you to do something. I have woven events together in perfect timing, and your absolute immediate obedience at times I speak to you is of the utmost importance now. I am moving my remnant to areas of strategic importance. I am moving the wicked into place as well. I know where safety is. I know where destruction will reign. It is all about to begin. You live in a time of excitement, my people, of the fulfillment of my holy word, a time when angels will labor side by side with you to bring about my will. A time when the greatest battles of all time will be won. You are soldiers called for such a time as this. Laborers sent forth into the harvest, a harvest that is white and at perfect readiness for the reaping. Those who are lukewarm in their belief in me will be cast into the darkness and destruction that is coming. Those who have great love for me will be guided and protected. You choose which group you are in. Ready yourselves, for this will be a bumpy ride, but an exciting one. You are seeing history made, and your responses now to all that transpires will be talked about in heaven for all eternity. Wow. This one's from Stephen Hansen toward the end of May. I'll just go ahead and read this. Praise God. Stephen Hansen. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be earthquakes in diverse places, and there shall be famines and troubles. These are the beginning of sorrows. Mark 13:8. Quote. What will you do, my people, when everything around you is being turned upside down? Who will you run to that will help you with these things? What will happen when the entire government system is shaken? What will be your focus on that day? For nation will be at war with nation. The deceit in the government system will run deeper than ever before. There will be an uprising, and the people will continue to march like never before, for there will be bloodshed on every corner. And then a marshaling of the troops will occur, for martial law will ensue. But black and white will band together, and those in charge will flee to their caves and bunkers. These things must come. And then a great leader will emerge. He will not bow down to me or any other. For those of mine who remain true to me will find safety in those days. Wow. Here's another one from Wings of Prophecy. Just praise him from the end of May. My people will walk in destruction. Children, you have wondered how to navigate the destruction that is coming. That's true. I have wondered. I tell you, it is not possible in your own strength, but you shall be well able to navigate it in mine. If you will draw nearer to me in the secret place where we meet, if you will spend more time in my presence and in my word, I will guide you. As you spend more and more time with me, you begin to hear me whispering into your spirit. You will hear me guiding you. This guidance is how you navigate what is coming. My voice is how you will walk in that time. My guidance is how you will survive. My people will walk for a time in the destruction, to guide those who are lost to me. The work of my kingdom will be all but abandoned when these things happen, and many souls will seek to know me then. Only those who do know me can guide them. But fear not, for you shall not dwell among destruction for long. Your home is here with me. All right, praise God. And we got to head into the news section. And then we're going to be bringing on in about roughly 15 minutes, Sister Susan Davis, praise Jesus. And I have her number written down here that she gave us, and hopefully she'll be calling in on that number. It's 317-585. Sister Susan, if you are listening to the program, we'll be looking at you, looking for you to call in from the 317-585 number, praise Jesus, all right? And don't forget to press 1 to talk to the host when you call in so that you pop to the top of the call queue, hallelujah. All right, and on that note, let's go ahead and hit the news section of the show. We're going to have to move pretty quick through this. Praise God.
It's not normal.
All right. What's amazing is that this is being printed out on WorldNet Daily, right? All right. Listen to this headline from WorldNet Daily. Okay, and they actually have a link to the source, which is Reuters, but they're reprinting it on their website. And the headline reads: Ayatollah agrees Obama created ISIS. And it says you, the United States, and your agents are the source of the instability. Reuters. Iran Supreme Leader Ayatollah Ali Khamenei on Monday blamed the United States for instability in the Middle East and said Washington's fight against the Islamic State militant group was a lie. You, the United States, and your agents are the source of the instability in the Middle East. Who created the Islamic State? America. America claims of fighting against the Islamic State is a lie, Khamenei said in a meeting with a high-ranking Iranian officials. According to this official website, Iran and the United States cut diplomatic ties shortly after Iran's 1979 Islamic Revolution and enmity to Washington and has long been a rallying point for hardline supporters of Khamenei in Iran. Of course, he neglects to mention that Obama gave him, like, I don't know how many billion dollars worth of pure cash and 10 metric tons of uranium and a pat on the head and said, have fun with your centrifuges. Anybody who thinks this world is normal. Oh, okay. There's another one. Wait. Don't want to repeat. All right. Listen to this. This is from the Daily Beast. Listen to this. Time is running out. You can say that again. Headline, United States power companies are warning of a, quote, nightmare cyber weapon already causing blackouts in, well, the U.S. and evidently other places as well. By the way, this was one of those things I was talking to that very, very high-ranking official at that billion-dollar global company. We were talking about this very thing. We were talking about the Snowden hacks because, you know, we're both cybersecurity people, and this very thing, blackouts. Nightmarish blackout situations, control of the power grid, the takedown of power grids in different countries is an act of cyber war. These are things that are very real. These are not. This is not theory. It was maybe theory back in the 1990s a little bit, but not anymore. This is standard cyber warfare now. And we can expect it to happen for sure. Quote, weather apocalypse hits Wisconsin and Minnesota. 80,000 homes without power, 2,000 flights delayed. Praise Jesus. Listen to this. Charisma News. Legendary investor Jim Rogers warns that the worst stock market crash in your lifetime is coming this year or next. And it goes on to explain all of his reasoning behind it, this and the other thing. Folks, here's the thing that I always say about the financial collapse. There's another one here. City and Business News, financial chaos warning. Huge Trump storm looms over Wall Street, says ex-Reagan director. A horrendous storm is gathering over Wall Street as Donald Trump's failure to push through the promised tax and economy reforms is set to wreak chaos, according to the chilling predictions by a former U.S. budget director under President Ronald Reagan. So they're coming forward again. And what I tell people, folks, is you know what? I get emails from people like, should I invest in Bitcoin? And I'm like, nah, forget it, man. When this stuff goes down, look, the scripture says that they will throw their silver and gold out in the streets. Look what happened with Argentina when the Illuminati did the practice session that they're doing the same thing in Venezuela. I mean, you got Hugo Chavez. He comes out and says George Bush is the devil, which he wasn't too far from the truth there, folks. In the book Transformation of America by Kathleen O'Brien, she saw George Bush shapeshift into a reptilian lizard creature. Of course, she said, well, maybe it was because of the drugs they had me on. No. Okay, and so you got Hugo Chavez. He's telling everybody they got CIA people. They're in the jungles. They're trying to kill me. Guess what? They did. They did. And who do they got right now? A patsy, a pawn in the game. And what are they doing? A practice session, an Illuminati practice session, so that they can map out the behavior of those human and beings. What are they going to do? We got to practice. We got to prepare. We got to move the MRAPs and all the military equipment and black ops and all that stuff and the helicopters and, got to be ready. Maybe we'll have another Jade Helm. Bank of America, Delta pull out of Shakespeare in the Park over Trump assassination scene. They actually build in a Trump assassination scene into Shakespeare in the Park play. Delta Airlines and Bank of America pulled their sponsorship out of New York City's public theater. Said, forget that. That's too dark. Well, anyway, we don't know what's going to happen, folks, but one of the conversations that I had with that, high-level executive was designated survivor possibility in the destruction of Washington, D.C., and the kicking in of PDD 51, which, by the way, he was familiar with. Folks, wow. Hallelujah. All right, let's go ahead and do As in the Days of Noah. American Medical Association adopts transgender policies. So now it says broadening how gender identity is defined within medicine. So now, So, yep, seems like every week there's just continues to get more and more bizarre. Possible Russian alien discovery as mystery satellite circles the ISS. And this is really actually kind of a fascinating article on what's going on up there. But they have gotten a lot of – the weirdness at the ISS seems to be amped up in a big way. It's obviously pervasive enough or so overt that the forces of darkness can't blot it out of their videos. They're leaking out into the to us. We're reporting on it. All right, praise God. Christian News, elementary school principal announces to parents that she is transitioning into man. All right, and Sister Mary Lee is letting me know that Sister McDonald is on 317-201. Now, that is not the number that I received. So let me see if I can find that. Wait a minute. No, I have the number. Sister Mary Lee, I have the number that Sister Susan said she would be calling in on, the 317-585 number. It is holding in the queue. So I'm going to go over to that number in a couple of minutes when we get to the guest segment. I got to finish the news articles. Thank you, Sister Mary Lee. God bless you. Elementary school principal announces parents that she is transitioning into a man. Elementary school, folks. I'm sure the kids will be like, okay. Dueling and witchcraft are coming back to Canada. Doling, as it is spelled in Canada, has been brought back into the public eye by the success of the musical Hamilton, just as witchcraft, spelled the same way in Canada, was made fun of again by the success of the musical Wicked, now in Canada, is considering making a Doling and witchcraft legal again. I don't think they have to make it legal, folks. They're going to, the forces of darkness will be practicing the darkness, whether it's legal or not, as we know here in this country. All right, and now, signs in the sun and the moon and the star seas roaring. Hallelujah. Reuters, strong quake kills one in church, collapses in Guatemala, shakes Mexico. As a matter of fact, now, Mary Lee, I do see your communications, and again, I appreciate that. Thank you. God bless you. But I have, once again, I do have the number for Susan Davis. She is on hold, and she is on the number that she said she was calling from, and it's 317-585. Praise God. So hang in there, Sister Susan. We'll be bringing you live in a second. All right, praise God. So again, this morning, my little silencer on my phone, by coincidence, just happened to stop silencing right prior to the magnitude 7 earthquake hitting Guatemala. And then, you know, I prayed for the people there, because in those parts of the world, you know, that are underprivileged and their architecture is not up to snuff, a magnitude 7 earthquake can be devastating. So praise God, not that many people evidently were affected adversely by it. Mazaram cut off from the rest of India's landslides blocked the national highway number 54. So they're having just awful problems, you know, with rain and incredible intense heat and people dying in India. Sudan, terrible. Pray for those people. It's just amazing. Millions, another headline, millions and millions of fish dying in Matagorda Bay, Texas, and nobody knows why. And they have film footage and it's bad. Praise God. Listen to this. Heat wave to plague California, with some areas to hit 122 degrees Fahrenheit. That's the same temperature that's slamming parts of India and Pakistan right now. I think there are up to 250 people have died from that. So hopefully the electrical systems will stay working in Southern California so that they can weather that surge. Wow. Listen to this. 77 buried alive as they slept, with many more missing in Bangladesh just 2 weeks after 300,000 people were evacuated due to Cyclone Mora. And they're pulling people out of the mud and the mudslides. It's just a terrible. Pray for them. Tornado and hail outbreaks in the United States, with more than 30 tornadoes reported in Nebraska, Wyoming, South Dakota, and Colorado. I had somebody send me a photograph of one of the hail balls, or whatever you want to call it. Wow. It's like huge, but not as huge as they're going to get. An unending disaster. Over 242 houses submerged and properties destroyed in the latest tidal waves that hit Volta region in Ghana, Africa. Wow. And again, to support what I was just saying earlier, massive hailstorm coming out of nowhere, pounds gathering in Bangladesh. People flee for their lives, and they are. They are. Praise Jesus. Hallelujah. And the last section of the news is New World Order, wars, rumors of wars, upheaval and rumors of wars. Praise Jesus. CBS Baltimore, officers to be put on 24-hour shifts as city violence increases. Baltimore. Listen to this. San Francisco UPS facility shooting. 4 people dead, including gunmen, police say. Most people in the United States of Babylon the Great do not realize that happened, because there was also a attempted multi-murder event that occurred in Virginia during a Republican congressman baseball practice session early this morning. So there was a shooter, an active shooter event, where a fellow who just, you know, was very anti-Trump, very anti-Republican, got a rifle, went there and started taking shots. Some 50 shots were fired, and that was plastered all over the news all day long. And they slipped in the report on the 4 people that died for UPS at the UPS facility. But you know, wow. Listen to this. London Inferno, another report that kind of fell into the background here in the United States of Babylon the Great. No one on the top 3 floors survived. 12 dead, 78 injured, as the fire still raged. Okay, and they, the last time I looked into this report, by the way, they expected the body count would be a lot higher. This is a very bad situation. Wow. It's just like the apocalyptic news never ends. It just gets worse and worse every single show. Video emerges of the United States allowing ISIS fighters to escape safely in Syria. And sure enough, They had the video, and sure enough, they're escaping. And yeah, okay. So the allegations that were coming from Khamenei evidently were true, and they're not the only ones. There's the evidence is overwhelming. Trump administration uses Saudis for its next, quote, controlled chaos project, according to this article out of Sputnik News in Russia, which, by the way, brace yourselves. The stuff in the Middle East is going to bubble up and get really, really bad. You can believe it. It's been prophesied. God's shown people it in visions, and we know that we're on the precipice of World War III. Which is going to include the Psalm 83 war, the Gog and Magog invasion, all kinds of stuff. It's going to include the Behold the Pale Horse, a quarter of the earth, and his name is Death. And all this, oh, folks, we are right on the edge of these things breaking loose. Hallelujah. Another one, Gospel Herald Society. Christians seized in Detroit will be mutilated and slaughtered by ISIS if deported to Iraq, warns Chaldean leaders. And there's, you know, they're talking about being deported under, you know, the new ICE rules and stuff under Trump. And if they get sent back, well, they'll get slaughtered. And again, it just goes on and on. A cholera epidemic, 250,000 people affected. Cholera is very bad, folks. People die really quick if they don't get the right medical attention. And this is like Yemen, right? It's going to get a lot worse. Pray for these people, folks. It is absolutely horrible. ICE arrest in Metro Detroit terrify Iraqi Christians. So this is another report from CNN regarding the same dynamic. All right, and again, 12 injured after a Molotov cocktail thrown into a Paris suburb restaurant. Who heard about that today? I didn't. If it wasn't for doing the radio show, I wouldn't even have known that happened. So the chaos continues to increase. The ramp up to World War III continues to increase. Nothing has changed. Folks, we need to be at the ready because we don't know when our Heavenly Father is going to pull the big red lever and all heck is going to break loose across the world. Glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus, because that's when we get out into the streets and touch people's lives. We ought to be doing it now, but we're going to be doing it gangbusters when the darkness rolls across this country and other countries as well. Praise Jesus. And on that note, let's go ahead and bring on Sister Susan Davis. Davis. Hallelujah. All right, praise God. So we're having the mystery of the rotating phone numbers occurring here. I did have Susan Davis on the 317-585 number, but I'm just going to go ahead and, out of faith on what Sister Mary Lee sent me, I'm going to go ahead and try this line and see if this is her. Praise Jesus. All right, and this is a different number. All right, let me see if this is Sister Susan. Sister Susan, are you there? Hi,
hello.
Is this Susan?
Yeah, hi.
Hi, praise God. The numbers for you were changing like in near real time. So praise Jesus. I'm glad I got the right one. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
But we're blessed to have you on the program. There have been so many recent writings and articles that your ministry has put out to folks that have been monitoring it, none the least of which, of course, is the Winds of War article. The Winds of War are blowing, but there's others as well. And you know what? I know that the Lord and the Holy Spirit move through you when you speak, and we've been blessed in the past immensely by your message. And I would just like to go ahead. Well, you know how we do things here. I'll just fade off into the background. I'm not going anywhere, but I'll fade off into the background, and I'll sit in my virtual folding chair behind the podium and kind of just say, here you go. Here's the mic. Talk to the people, whatever the Lord places in your heart. So here you go. Here's your microphone.
Wow. Okay. Well, hi, and thank you so much for having me back, by the way. I really appreciate it. And so I'm here to talk to the audience about the times we're living in, right? And, well, here is something I'd like to talk about. One of the things that I do is I do End Time News Report on Facebook. And it's a Facebook page that anybody can go to. And daily we put up headlines from around the world. And not just any headlines. We actually put up things that go along with all the scriptures that said would be playing out in the last days. So we glean through the news, the daily news, and we pull up actual headlines that coordinate with Scripture. So we flush out all the other, you know, fantastic stuff that you have to, you know, see by the news, and we just post things that are specifically oriented to the end times. And see, we've been doing this since, oh boy, I want to say 2010. I've been doing End Time News Report, started out emailing, and then the reports got so cumbersome and so much was going on, we had to move into the Facebook format because it lent itself more to fast and furious headlines. And as an observer, I would have to say that it is amazing. Since 2010, I would say the birth pains are actually coming closer together and faster and more furious and more with greater impact, which is exactly how the Bible describes the last days, that it would be like the birth pains of a woman giving birth. And so that's exactly what we're seeing, because some of the news that I put out in a single day is what I would have put out in about a two-week period of time back in 2010. And so I don't know if that means anything to your audience, but it ought to, because, I mean, we're really seeing some amazing things going on. And what we're seeing is just, I mean, it's the whole range of things that the Bible said would happen. I mean, many predicted so long ago, thousands of years ago, hundreds of years ago, and it's coming together with precision. And so it's real exciting, the times we're living in. But, I mean, there's a lot to talk about, because we're seeing an uptick of landslides, and I'd like to address this. I was doing a presentation for a church not too long ago, and I was working on this presentation, and I happened to stumble. I guess stumble wouldn't be a good word. It was probably directed by the Lord. But I came across the USGS survey section, which is the United States Geological Survey, and I found something that just about threw me right out of the chair. I saw that in 1996, there was somewhere around 10 or 12 landslides a year listed on their website, 10 or 12 a month. And by the year, I want to say 2007 approximately, landslides were coming at a rate of 600 a month. And that was in about, 2016. So I couldn't believe what I was seeing. And I had the statistics, and it was just mind-boggling. I couldn't believe that there was such a jump between an average of 10 to 12 to 600. And at first you would say, wow, that's got to be an anomaly or a mistake. But to be, you know, I tracked it, and the landslides were actually gradually increasing. So it wasn't just that overnight it changed, but it was changing over time steadily. And so this is what's going on. In fact, there was just a landslide I reported on in Bangladesh just this week that buried 77 people alive. So there's scripture even in the Bible that talks about how the mountains are going to come down and God's going to bring them down as a sign. And so this is fantastic. But here's another thing that's really fantastic is, we're also, I was over there at the USGS site, and I know another guy who does end time news reporting, and those statistics have all been removed. And we cannot figure out why they're pulling these statistics off, but I think it's because I'm not sure, but maybe they just don't want people to know that there's something going on in the world, and it's notable, it's huge. And so the other thing that's going on in the world, if people hadn't noticed, is there's an unbelievable increase of flooding. There's flooding going on all over the planet. And we're talking about every single continent has been affected. And it's just like the days of Noah. And it's incredible. And I think it is also because the Antarctic, we see the ice masses are melting. And so there's more water in the system. And, of course, God is bringing this on to a world that is turning its back to the Lord. So we see that the world is coming unglued, and no surprise there, because they have turned their back to the Lord. And so when you reject God, then what happens? We start to see these things happen. In fact, what we see is a world that is coming apart, and now we're beginning to find out just exactly what God does for us, how he has kept everything in check for us all these many years, and now he's starting to pull his hand of protection away because the people don't want him. They are rejecting him, and we know this. And even the lukewarm church can't deny that the world is rejecting God from so many angles, politically, going against Israel, and in every way possible, in the school systems. You know, this idea that in Tel Aviv they just had a gay pride parade that had 200,000 some people in attendance. It's just phenomenal what we're seeing in the world right now. And we have created Facebooks for people to go to see these things. It's called End Times Landslides. And you can literally go over there and check that out. And almost every day we're posting landslides that are going on. We have another Facebook called End Times Sinkholes. And this is another phenomenon that's really amazing. Literally had a dream, I want to say about 5, 6, or 7 years ago. And the Lord showed me what was a house that broke in half and went down into this dark sinkhole. And then I had seen a staircase on the side of this dark sinkhole, and these dark figures were coming up out of the ground. Well, at the time, I knew, for some reason, I knew they were demonic, that they were demons. And I woke up from this dream. And I don't dream all that often, but this was a prophetic dream because at the time I thought, what in the world? What did I just witness, seeing a house break in half and then these demon spirits coming out of the ground up into out of this hole? And I thought, what kind of thing is this that a house would break in half and then just fall into this deep hole, cavernous hole? Well, it wasn't too long after that that there was the case of a man in Florida that his room just went down into a sinkhole, and they never recovered him. He never came back. And when I saw this news report, I was totally stunned because I was like, wow, I dreamt this. And then from that point on, the sinkhole thing was going on everywhere. There was like a sinkhole in a Corvette factory in Kentucky that swallowed a bunch of Corvettes in this Corvette museum. And then the sinkhole thing has just been going on all over the world. And but at the time that I had the dream, this was unknown. If there were sinkholes, I didn't know about it and I hadn't heard of it. So it was a new concept at that point. And we didn't grow up seeing the sinkholes now. But if you go over to End Time Sinkholes, you will see that you can see all these sinkholes that are opening up all over the world. And how does this relate to the Bible? Well, actually, the Lord used sinkholes back during the time of Korah. When, if we can go back and we see Moses and Aaron, who were over the Israelites when they were out in the wilderness, and Korah and a group of people came up against Moses, and basically, you know, was questioning him and saying, you know, who died and made you boss? And so that's where we see the Korra and the other troublemakers and the whole group were ordered to stand in front of their each of their own tents with their family. And Korra and the others that had challenged Moses and Aaron, they were swallowed up into the ground, never to be seen again, into these sinkholes. So the whole sinkhole thing is really like a form of God's wrath. And it's definitely, right now I believe it's a form of warning and, you know, a sign. And so if people would go over there, they could see this. I also had a staff person in Jamaica who helped with the End Times News report. She knew nothing of my dream. And she had sent me an email, and she said the Lord had given her a dream or a vision, and she saw an angel standing by a sinkhole and dark figures coming in and out of the sinkhole. And the angel said to her that these were demonic spirits. And I have since had another – I posted these things, and I had another person on Facebook say that this was also the case, that she had been told this by the Lord. And then I had another friend who does End Time News, and she said the Lord had told her as well that these sinkholes are opening up and releasing evil spirits into the earth from demonic spirits from hell. And we actually know by scripture that hell is in the earth. There's many scriptures that describe hell being in the center of the earth, and so it's biblical. I don't, you know, people may not believe such a thing, but it is in the Bible. If you believe in the Bible 100%, then this is accurate. It's right there in the scripture. So we've had another Facebook that you can go to, which is End Times Blood Rivers. This is another phenomenon. And all over the place, we're seeing blood rivers. And there was one just recently. I think it was in Africa. And they see it's mysterious. They don't know what's causing it. Sometimes it causes the animals to die. They say it's bacterial. I say it's a sign from God. But if you do go over there to End Times Blood Rivers, you'll see how this is just fantastic sign. Also, another sign out there that you can check out on one of our many Facebooks, End Time Facebooks, is End Time Signs in the Skies. Signs in the Skies. And this is truly phenomenal because what we're seeing is something that NASA can now track. All these kinds of things going on by computer, which is something that, you know, we've never been able to do before until now. And NASA has said that this many signs, and when I say signs, I'm talking about eclipses, solar eclipses, blood moons, all of these kinds of activities, this much activity that we've been witnessing. And you can go over there to End Time Signs in the Skies and see all of the data that we've posted. But this much activity will not happen again for 30 years, according to NASA. So that makes this very interesting because the Bible says that when this generation begins to see these things come into play, that they will not pass away before the Lord returns. So this is exciting times because 30 years from now, the generation that we're talking about would be long dead. So we are looking at the absolute perfect envelope or window of time in which the Lord is coming. And that is another one of the major signs, and that is the convergence of all of these prophetic warnings coming together simultaneously, pointing to the Lord's return. So we have to be watching now. The church needs to be sitting up and paying attention. Another sign that we have a Facebook for is the end times pestilence. And now this is really exciting from the standpoint that it is Bible prophecy coming to pass. But as far as being a good thing, it's not. But we're seeing all kinds of horrible things rear its ugly head. Everything from Ebola to Zika, ticks, bed bugs, you name it. There's all sorts of things. There's an upsurge of all these things. And again, what we're seeing is God lifting his hand of protection and over a world that is rejecting him and turning to sin. And so now we're beginning to see the effects of a world that has turned its back to God. And so, again, we track this daily, weekly. You can head over there, follow it. You can just hit follow, and you can see what these headlines are. They're coming in. And if anybody has seen anything about Ebola, that is probably one of the worst kinds of things that can happen to humanity is that particular disease. It's unbelievable. The other End Times Facebook that you might want to check out is called End Times Mass Animal Death. And this is huge. There are animals dying in mass literally all over this planet. And everything from fish to mammals to birds. And there is the avian flu, which there's cases of that all over the world. It's being tracked right now, and it's literally happening all over the world. And what that is involving is it's a kind of sickness that the birds are having to be destroyed and to, you know, so they don't infect the other birds. And so animals are being, these birds are being destroyed en masse. Also, fish are dying everywhere. They're coming into the shores in mass numbers on all shores. Literally, just about every continent of the world is experiencing this now. So the Lord had given me a major revelation regarding this, and it was just so phenomenal. And it had to do with the beginning of Christ. Ministry in the earth. When he first started to do his ministry, he went to Peter, and as who was a fisherman, and he had said for him to let down his net. And it was so exciting because, you know, we see that Peter, he says, "Oh Lord, I've been doing this all night long," and he had great doubts. And Jesus requested he do this, and he said, "But for you, you know, Rabbi, I will do this." And so he puts his net down, and as you know how the story goes, he pulls up a whole net full of fish, just amazing. And this is a turning point for Peter. You know, at this point, he realizes that he's not dealing with just anyone, and he, you know, declares to him that he needs his sins forgiven at that point, and he knows he's with someone very special, and if not God himself. And so this is a amazing part of the ministry of Christ beginning. Jesus invites Peter to come with him, and literally we see the ministry of Jesus forming at that point. And so the Lord had shown me this particular passage of the scripture, and what was going on at the time, life was teeming because Jesus was there, his ministry was beginning, and the fish were so abundant, and they were literally teeming with life. And so what we see is now, symbolically, the Lord is saying, now you're rejecting me. And you're pushing God away, you're rejecting Christ, and so all these dead fish is the opposite of what Peter saw when the ministry started, the fish were abundant and life was teeming. And so now the world is saying, no, we don't want Jesus. We don't want the message of Christ. And so what's going on? The fish symbolically are dying everywhere. Now, we know there may be some explanations for all this death. We know about Fukushima, which is over in Japan. And by the way, just a little update on Fukushima. They have not been able to stop Fukushima. It's still pouring radiation into the ocean. And this has been going on since March of 2011. And, you know, a lot of people, it's a great area of dispute. Some people say that it really isn't doing anything. And others, like myself, my opinion is it is doing something because there are animals dying in mass all over the place, not just fish, but all sorts of things. In fact, one of the things that concerns me greatly is that if the higher life forms are dying in mass, then also we have to believe that the lowest life forms are also in critical condition, which would be the phytoplankton. The phytoplankton are critical in that they feed the whales. They feed all sorts of animals. And without phytoplankton, we also have a depletion of oxygen in the ocean. And so this could be a real problem for us. Before Fukushima took place in Japan, the ocean was down, I think it was somewhere between 40 and 60% phytoplankton. Then we see this event with Fukushima and other kinds of pollution in the ocean, and you have to ask yourself, okay, if we were already down 40 to 60% phytoplankton, what has happened since Fukushima to the phytoplankton population? Well, I think that we're in trouble because we are seeing seal pups and all sorts of animals coming into the coast of California, and they are starving to death. They are literally coming into the shore, and their rib cages are showing, and they are coming in completely starved. And what these animals feed on are the lower life forms, which are the smaller fish and the phytoplankton. And I just want to add this to this comment that remember Jacques Cousteau, who was the famous undersea explorer, one of the first to take a camera underwater, and his son recently went on record before all this happened with Fukushima and everything, and he was saying that the whole ecosystem is so fragile that if one life form is taken out of the picture, it can destroy the whole system. And he cited an example of a fish that was introduced to an area of in the ocean in the world that didn't belong there, and it became it came in and became the high predator and destroyed the whole area because it was not meant to be in that area, and it just took over and destroyed everything. And he cited this as an example that the life forms and the whole system works together so critically that if one thing comes in and changes that system, the whole thing can fall apart. And so what in the world are the ramifications if you have animals dying in mass all over the world? I mean, in Chile, if you look at this report, you can see that there are literally thousands and thousands and thousands of squid that are coming in mass. Well, what are the ramifications of that? What are the ramifications of fish that are dying in by tons and tons on various shorelines around the world? You know, we don't know. We've never experienced anything like this before. This is the first time. So really, if you go over to End Times mass animal deaths, you've got to go over and look at these Facebooks, because, you know, to see it is to believe it. The pictures, a picture is worth a thousand words. And I tell you, if you go down and you look at the floods that are going on in the world, the landslides, the sinkholes, the mass animal deaths, and you take a look at all these things, it's extraordinary. And these are actually, in a way, these are tools that we are using to try to reach people for the Lord, to show people that we are actually in the end time. And if they would just go over and take a look at these articles and these pictures, because I know people get real busy, they're busy in their own worlds, and it just seems like, you know, if you go to the average person, even a Christian, and say, do you think we're in the end time? And they just are kind of like, well, maybe, I don't know, probably not. But if they could see these photos and all these stories and everything that we're showing, the, you know, crazy weather patterns, parts of the world that one of the most amazing things is where you see parts of the world where there's a desert region and they're having snow. And then you go to an area where there's snow and there, you know, it's all melting and there's record heat. I mean, we've got a world that's just topsy-turvy and it's coming apart. Well, this is God. He's trying to send a signal to people. He's trying to wake the people up. And of course, the Bible says that in the last days, the people will listen to, they'll put pastors and preachers who tickle their ears, and you know they will be lulled asleep and they won't wake in time. And so we are literally at that juncture, but we are actually seeing a rise of the demonic in the world. And just as I had mentioned that myself and three other ladies have received revelations from the Lord that the demonic spirits are being released into the world that have been held hostage in hell, and now they're coming out into the world. How can you believe that? Well, John was talking earlier about the invisible war, the winds of war blowing. Well, there's an invisible war. And that is the war that we fight every day with the powers and the principalities of the air. And we can see that there is an uprising of the demonic in the world, because there are planes crashing, there are boats going down, there are terrible accidents, car accidents, there are suicides and, you know, double suicides and triple and quadruple suicides going on. And there's all kinds of evil rising up in the world. This is all being orchestrated by the devil. And he is the one who is bringing all this about. But it's remarkable, because it's really, it's taking off like crazy. And it's, you can see it. You can see the demonic moving into over the world, and all the terrible things going on, and also all the sin and sin-related things, and just men's hearts waxing cold. Over at End Time News Report, that's one of the many things that we post over there, is articles that range from, you know, fantastic weather, but specifically men's hearts waxing cold. And we are seeing some of the most unbelievable evil that's taking place around the world, grotesque things. And, you know, for a while, some of the news reports that I would get were just so fantastic and grotesque that I was like, well, I mean, this is just, I just wasn't even sure if that was for public consumption, because, but, you know, I needed to go ahead and post some of this because I wanted to kind of shock the people. I want to shock them into seeing that there's something horrible going on, and that we're seeing some of the worst things in the world. And so I started to go ahead and post these things, although I know that people are like, wow, but we've got to get people to wake up and to realize the hour that we live in. And so we've just been trying to go ahead and just put up everything, you know, regardless of the nature, and to show people. And, you know, it, like I said, back in 2010, when we did the End Time News Report, we would put out a report once every 2 weeks. We had a lot of headlines, but now it's going out daily. Pretty much every single day, we're putting out as many headlines as we put out in a two-week period in 2010. And that is a clear-cut indication that the birth pains are coming closer together and they're coming more intensely. Another sign that we're seeing are large-size earthquakes that are taking place in areas that have never had earthquakes recently or ever. And another thing that's going on is volcanoes are going off like crazy and all over the world. That's another huge phenomenon that we're experiencing. Volcanoes that have been dormant for something like 300 years or for, you know, very long periods of time that are all of a sudden coming to life, and they're producing large amounts of smoke and ash. And it's just incredible to watch this. I know I received a prophetic word not too long ago. I was actually just doing my laundry. I wasn't even thinking about anything related to end times. And the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said the word Krakatoa. And at the time, I was like, Krakatoa? I mean, it sounded like something I recognized. Well, I immediately went to look it up, and I looked at the word, and I was like, oh, Toa, in the late 1800s, was a volcano that was so powerful that it killed, I think it was about 30,000 people back in the late 1800s, and it just changed the whole scenery around of that area. Well, now Krakatoa is in an area with a very large, massive infrastructure built around it because, you know, wind the clock up 100 and so many years, and now we've got large number of people living around Krakatoa. If that thing were to go like it did in the late 1800s, it could be massively dangerous to that geography. But interestingly enough that the Lord would put that on my mind, because when I did the research, the scientists are saying that Krakatoa is looking like it may possibly erupt again, and it's showing signs of the possibility. Now, this is what really threw me for a loop regarding this. Since the Lord gave me the word on Krakatoa, there were two other volcanoes right on both sides of Krakatoa that have since started erupting. So that whole area, that whole region is showing signs of activity after being dormant for a long time. And now, do I believe Krakatoa could be something that would go before the removal of the church? I actually believe that Krakatoa could actually be one of the major sudden impact or sudden destruction events because it's so massive. It's actually the kind of thing that it could put so much soot and dust into the atmosphere that it could, you know, block out the view of the sun. And that's exactly what happened when it erupted back in the 1800s. It was a huge event. And, boy, we just, you know, we don't know what's going to happen in, you know, the coming days, years, months, however God, whatever his timing is. But we can see that one of the greatest things, one of the greatest signs of what's going on in the world is a world that's turning its back to Israel. And one of the scriptures, one of the most famous scriptures in the Bible is when they say peace and safety, there will be none, and sudden destruction will come on, and they will not escape. And I want everybody to note that that particular scripture, it says, when they say, well, it's really interesting. Everybody's saying peace and safety. The Jordanian king, Israel's talking about it now. The European Union's talking about it. President Trump's talking about it. That would be in the United States. Many, many countries have voted for the two-state solution at the United Nations. I mean, it's just fantastic how many people are talking about it. Of course, the PA, Palestinian authorities, talking about it. The Saudis, I mean, it's just everybody's talking about peace and safety. And their answer is the two-state solution. Well, the two-state solution is dividing Israel. And the Lord has said, do not touch. Do not touch. Israel is about the size of New Jersey. And God has said, you know, you can touch anything in the world, but don't touch this land right here. And that's exactly bring peace and safety. Well, the reality is, if they can carve up Israel and they can get rid of Israel, that's the goal. They want, the secular world wants to get rid of God and the whole concept of God. And that's how they plan to do it, whether they're doing it consciously. And so this is yet another revelation the Lord has given me, is that in the Bible it says he's already committed adultery in his heart. And if a man hates his brother, he has And so the Lord has said that they are saying peace and safety. This is what they want. And so they've already committed this act in their hearts. And so that's all it takes. They don't have to actually do this, because the scripture says when they say. It never says that they actually go through with it. But the Lord has said that they already have this in their hearts to do this to Israel and to God, basically. And so basically it's already done. It's already done as far as God's concerned, because it's done in their hearts. They've already done it. And so now we're just going to have to see what happens from this point on. But we know that nothing good will come from this, because here's a great sign of what kind of danger zone they're entering into by, touching Israel. Back in, I want to say, 2010, March of 2010, March 11, to be specific, Japan voted against Israel at the United Nations. And 1 year to the date, March 11, 2011, the anniversary of Japan voting against Israel, and they had in 1 day a massive tsunami, a blood river, a volcano erupt, an earthquake, and a nuclear disaster in 1 day, which is, as we know today, Fukushima. And Fukushima has not been stopped. Fukushima is a mess. And so all this took place in 1 day, and we know what happened with the tsunami that took place. It was a huge amount of loss of life and a huge amount of loss in general, and very costly to Japan. And also Fukushima has the amount of money they've spent trying to deal with Fukushima is unbelievable. And if anybody wants any information on that whole story and what's going on with that, I'd be glad to send them the notes or send them to the right place, because although we don't hear much about this on the news, it's a phenomenal mess. And but this is what happens when people touch Israel. And there are many things that have happened in the past that have showed that when anybody goes after Israel, there will be a price to pay for it. And so this whole idea that everybody's coming down against Israel is absolutely scriptural. The Bible says that Israel will be a cup of trembling to the whole world. And we can see it. We can see it happening. And all of these things are coming together. It's huge. It's clear. Really, any Christian in the world right now, I recommend highly that you immediately run to the Lord and repent and grab your Bibles and start reading, two or three chapters a day, and get to know the Lord as your best friend. Talk to him all through the day. Surrender yourself over. I know John speaks about this constantly when he's on the air, and it's true. This is not the time to have the Lord Jesus as a stranger. We need to be totally surrendered and submitted to him. In fact, the Bible, one of the scriptures the Lord has put on my heart to talk to people the most about is the scripture that says, Lord, Lord, didn't we prophesy in your name? Didn't we work wonders in your name? Didn't we cast out demons or devils in your name? And he turns to them and he says that he never knew them. And he said, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. And I tell people that this is the church, the lukewarm church he's addressing. It's not even the secular, non-Christian, pagan, heathen, whatever you want to say, people, atheists. It's the church, because you cannot cast out devils. You cannot, you can't prophesy. You can't work wonders without a measure of the Holy Spirit. You can't do any of those things without the Holy Spirit. And they say they did these things in the Lord's name, and yet he tells them that they are to depart from him, and he doesn't know them, and that they're workers of iniquity. Well, this scripture was so terrifying to me as a Christian. I read this and I thought, well, who can make the cut? who's going to make it? This is terrifying. And so I had asked the Lord if he would, show me what this means. And because even as many, Christians that I know in many churches, they're not even casting out devils and working wonders and prophesying. They're not even doing that. But so the Lord took me to the study of the word new. In the Bible, where he says in that passage, I never knew you. And so the Lord took me to do a study on the word new in the Bible. And then he took me to Genesis, where it says Adam knew Eve. Then he took me into the New Testament, and where the angel is coming to Mary. And the angel says to Mary, that she would be the mother of Jesus, the Son of God. And she says, whoa, wait a minute, I've never known a man. And so we see also that Judah in the Old Testament knew his daughter-in-law. And so what does the word know mean in Scripture, and how it's used in that particular instance, is intimacy. you know, these people are saying intimacy. They're talking about the closest relationship you could have with someone is marriage, intimate relationship. So Jesus is literally saying in that passage, I never knew you. He's saying, I have never been intimate with you. We aren't close. You never called me. You don't talk to me every day. And so it's kind of one of those things in with ministry is like where a lot of pastors are doing ministry, but they don't know the God of their ministry. They don't have a relationship with him. And this is really serious because that's the lukewarm church look. It's so serious that Jesus literally says to them, depart from me. And he doesn't mean just get away from me for a little time. He's saying depart from me for eternity. And he calls them workers of iniquity. So what is the other key scripture is those who are in the will of the Father. And I talk about that is so important because Jesus himself was in the will of the Father. He literally says at the point where he's about to take the cup and drink the cup, which is to be crucified, he's praying in the garden, and he says to his Father, Lord, take this cup from me, and which is, you know, I really don't want to go through with this whole horrible crucifixion thing, and but then he says, nevertheless, not my will, but yours. And so he goes on, he does drink the cup, he does go out there and takes a horrible beating on our behalf and is crucified. So another passage, Jesus says, I don't come in my own will, but in the will of he who sent me, who is the Father. And so Jesus is saying through these various scriptures that he doesn't even operate in his own will, he operates in the will of the Father. Well, my question is for everybody, if Jesus Christ walked the earth and he himself declared that he himself did not operate in his own will but the will of the Father, then who in the world do we think we are that we should not be operating in the will of the Father if Jesus himself came down here, conducted his ministry, and operated in the will of the Father? So that is the key scripture in that passage, that those who are in the will of the Father, we have to be in the will of the Father because every other do is absolutely not good if it's in our own will. And that's why we are workers of iniquity. That's why the Lord says, hey, you can do all these good works, but if you're doing them in your own will, it's iniquity. And that goes back to the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Again, this is amazing teaching that the Lord gave me was in the garden when Adam and Eve ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. I understand what evil is, but my question for the Lord was, what in the world is good? I mean, they ate off the tree of evil, that why didn't you just call it the tree of evil? But it's the knowledge of good and evil. Well, the knowledge of good in this particular passage is the concept that when people are operating in their own will, and this is very interesting because one of the first things in the satanic Bible is do as you will, not do as God the Father says, but do as you will. But basically, interestingly enough, if we do things in our own will, even if we're a ministry people, and if it looks so good, it doesn't matter. If it's not the will of the Father, it doesn't matter how good it looks. And an example of that is, you know, you take all these celebrities who are living absolutely immoral lives in front of the whole world, you know, having children out of wedlock and all of these things. And then they go and they do wonderful things in Africa. They help children in Africa. They help with, you know, cancer and all these different projects. And the world just praises them. And it's like, well, it's very confusing. It's double-minded. But the main message is the knowledge of good has to do with an atheistic world that says we can do good. We don't need God. We don't need God. We can do good, and we don't need God. And that is the problem with the knowledge of good. It's evil men saying that they can do all this good. They can set up a whole culture, a whole world apart from God and run it apart from God. We don't need God. And so you go back to that other passage that I was saying, that they were working wonders. They were casting out devils. And they were doing all these things in the Lord's name, and then ultimately, because they were outside of the will of the Father, then Jesus declares that they were workers of iniquity. And so that's how that all comes together. So we as Christians, we need to surrender our lives to the will of the Father. We need to repent and make Jesus our Lord and Master, and we need to be filled with the Holy Spirit, which we need to ask that every day. Lord, please keep filling my oil lamp. I want to make sure that when you come back that you will see my oil lamp, that I won't be a half full or a partially filled oil lamp like the lukewarm church, like the five virgins that are left behind. And so these are things that we need to be praying for. And I think John had wanted me to touch on the book Marriage Supper of the Lamb, which is a book that is available. It's absolutely free online. It can be downloaded. And now we've got it in multiple languages. We've got it in several languages. I don't think I could even remember them all to list them, but we've got it in Russian and Japanese and Spanish and some other languages. But this book was something that the Lord called me to do. I was called, we have a family cabin, and I went there, and really and truly the Lord had called me there. I thought that it was strictly just something that was about me and my situation with the Lord, and I went down there, and the Lord had dealt with me on some issues that I needed dealing with, and that's in the book. You'll read it. And but when I got down there, the Lord started to speak to me and give me letters, and there are 38 to be exact. These letters were really powerful. They were talking about end times, what the church can expect when they go to heaven, what heaven's going to be like, some of these things, some of the main issues of the Lord, some of the hot buttons for the Lord, which are things like forgiveness, trusting the Lord. These are all topics that he covers. So when I came back from my fast, which it was a 40-day fast, and I just basically had water, and it was very difficult. But when I came back and I brought these 38 letters, I had a publisher at that time, and I sent these letters to him, and he was so bowled over that he had the project turned around into a book within like 2 months. And so we started putting that out, and it was 2012. But there were many things that happened to me during that time when I was in this cabin, and some fantastic things. And I was alone there, and the Lord, you know, really opened up to me about humility. The importance of humility, and that's also written in the book. The last chapter of the book is my testimony about this particular book and how I came to do it. And so as it turned out, there are 39 chapters, which is really amazing because of Jesus having 39 stripes. I think it's extremely symbolic. It was not planned. I did not plan this. I did not know that there would be exactly 38 letters plus one more chapter. And I had no idea that it would turn out like this. This was all God's plan. He's the one that put this all together. But, you know, I invite people to, you know, feel free to contact us or just look up Susan Davis, Marriage Supper of the Lamb, and you can download this book. It's absolutely free. Like I said, we have it in many languages. We now have it in audio format. You can listen to it. You can see it on YouTube. And it is available for everybody. We have other books as well. And so those are also free. So we try to make these things available to people. So all of our materials are absolutely free for anybody to get at any point. And we have lots of Facebooks that people can visit. We have one called What the Lukewarm Church Won't Teach You, which is one of my personal favorites because we talk a lot about the things that are important to the Lord that the churches are not speaking on today. And we know in the last days that the people are not going to hear the truth from the mainstream churches, and we know that. So basically, you know, I really, and John, did you have any questions for me?
No. No. As a matter of fact, I'm taking notes as fast as I can go.
Wow,
here.
Give Susan a microphone. She just talked.
End times landslides, end times sinkholes, end times news report, end times blood rivers, end times signs in the sky, end times pestilence. I signed up for all of them. I liked them all. I don't even know how Facebook worked, but I'm like, man, if you guys are going to do all this work for us, then we got to accept it. Praise God.
Right.
You know what I mean? If you're finding stuff that we don't know about and we can bring it forward to people on this program, then what a blessing that is. Praise God. And I was also, I'm also putting together an email for you and Donna. It has a link to John Mulindy's testimony at IHOP. And because you had said that you had been doing all this study and meditating and working with the Lord and everything regarding Matthew 7:21, you know, not everyone says to me in that day, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven. And, you know, many, you remember, what was the name of that guy that was on, what was it, you know, and now, you know, the rest of the story, the rest of the story. It's inside the John testimony. Yeah, I forget his name, but anyway, the rest of the story to what the Lord has shown you, because everything that the Lord showed you, it absolutely resonates with and with my spirit, and all I'm saying is check, amen. Now I'm tossing over to the wall to you another piece of the puzzle, which is going to blow your mind. Because this other piece of the puzzle goes hand in hand, because there's always just a little more to the puzzle. We, you know, as we dig, we find more and more stuff. And then, and the other piece of the puzzle is that key part where he says, "You who practice lawlessness or iniquity or whatever." So I could not agree with you more about being out of the Father's will. That, you know, the Scripture says that which is not from faith is sin. Anyone in the book of James, it says, you know, I'm totally paraphrasing, but it says, he who knows to do good but does not do it, to him it is a sin. Then you go to Ephesians 5:27 in regard to the description of the bride. It's a mystery scripture that, you know, pretty much 99% of churchianity, you know, mysteriously overlooks. And it's the key to understanding, you know, the requirement for being part of the bride of Jesus Christ, because not everybody will make that. You know, many are called, few are chosen. And Ephesians 5:27 is the key, that he, Jesus, might present her, the bride, to himself a glorious church, not having, this is very important, not having a spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. And one might say, well, How is that possible? Lord, please help me out. Just pretty much eliminates everybody. No, it doesn't. No, it doesn't. Here's the secret. These are the things that I cry about. I've been seeking the Lord on my knees in tears for years. The key to understanding, this took me, Lord, years and years of time to reveal this to me. 1 John 3:7, this is righteousness, is righteous just as he, Jesus, is righteous. But he who sins is of the devil.
Amen.
The key there is we are in a constant state of 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 28 through 30.
Exhortation.
So we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged. That's what it says. We would not be judged and chastened by the Lord. So the key is we are walking in the Spirit. We are constantly monitoring and examining our heart, our intents, every thought. We are holding every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ, 2 Corinthians 10:5. We're doing this because it's part of who we are and part of our walk, and we do not want to sin and desecrate the cross because we love our Father and we love our Lord Jesus. So there, the one little piece, the that really freaked me out. I'm telling you, I had my and I still deal with this. It freaks me out to this day. And that is, while I get the practicing righteousness stuff, I did not know how, I don't know what the right word is, how terrifyingly serious God takes this. When God, through His inspired text, says, having not a spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she, the bride, should be holy and without blemish. He takes that extremely seriously. He's not playing. He means business. Now, this is about the bride. This isn't about basic salvation. This is in regard to being the bride of Jesus Christ, which is what, which are the wise virgins. The foolish virgins are also saved, you know, and they're going to go through a lot of hell on, you know, on the Great Tribulation and all that kind of ugly stuff. But they're not going to make the rapture. Only the bride makes the rapture, and she will be have no spot or wrinkle or any such thing. She'll be holy and without a blemish. Now, here's the thing. The John Melendi testimony is the key. Here's this guy. And I've told listeners this before, and I'll send you a link to this. Matter of fact, I'm going to send it to you right now. Let me go ahead and hit the send button. Send it to you and Donna. But in here you have this guy, John Melendi, who's still out there today. He's got one of the largest divine healing ministries. So think about the scripture. Lord, Lord, have we not cast out demons? Have we not done many wonders in your name? Now think about that and then check this out. So John Melendi, head guy, one of the largest divine healing ministries in the entire world, still in operation today. It's over in Africa. And he had a team of like six people. The Lord came upon him and others in the ministry team and said, you have sin in your team. So I'm giving you a super short version. They go off, they isolate themselves, they fast, they seek the Lord, and they come back and they meet. And everybody else on the team, except John, says, I got nothing. And John goes, uh-oh. He realized it was him, but he didn't understand. Mm. So he went back before the Lord, continued to fast, and the Lord came upon him and said, John, and I'm really cutting it short, you got to hear the whole thing to really get the gist of it. But he said the Lord came upon him. He was freaked out and in tears. And God told him, John, if I came for my bride today, I would not take you, John. Now, this is a guy that is raising people from, you know, out of wheelchairs. People are receiving sight.
Right.
Miracles are happening where he goes. And John said, oh, Father, that means that I have been healing people with the power of Satan. And the Father said, no, John, I healed them because I love the people. So the Lord would allow his power to move through John Melendi, even though John had willful sin in his life. Turns out that all he was doing was looking at pretty girls on the side of the street and, you know, thinking about them. That's all it took for him to be eliminated as a part of the bride of Jesus Christ. So, wow. Talk about bringing the hammer down. You know what I mean? I was like, no.
Well,
you know,
can I interject on this?
Oh, yeah.
If possible, do you mind if I just interject something for your audience on this at this juncture? Because I hear what you're saying. That's a very serious scripture. You know, when you were up late at night, you should have called me. I might have been up late at night on that same one with you.
Yeah,
but
I believe.
You know, here's how the Lord has shown this to me also, because it's like, you know, you love the Lord and then you start looking at this and you're going, wow, I don't know anybody that could, you know, cut this kind of mustard. But the Lord had showed me that we are perfected even as we are being perfected, because a certain amount of what we do is impossible for us to do. I mean, it's impossible for the flesh to be good because, you know, only the Father is good, and Jesus said that. But the thing is that when we choose for the Lord, we are perfected, because the Lord showed me we choose Him perfectly. By choosing God, every day we get up and we're like, I want to be on Team God today. I don't want to be on Team Devil. I'm going with Team God. We choose, we make a perfect choice. And by what Jesus Christ did on the cross for us, He brings us into a state of perfection even as we are being perfected, which means we're being sanctified, which is, it's not going to happen immediately, because, you know, if the Holy Spirit showed us our bad self all at once, we couldn't handle it. So He's like working with us every day. You know, we're discipling because we got to get into the Bible. We got to read, you know, our chapters every day, because, you know, being a disciple comes from the word discipline. And so we got a little bit of, you know, something to do. We can't just not do something. But it's the beauty of, you know, something that the churches aren't talking about, John, and let me express myself here. One of the biggest things is childlike faith. The churches are totally overlooking that. We have to be like children. We have to come to the Lord like children, you know. We have to say, Lord, I don't know how to do this. I don't know how to be, you know, right with You. I don't know what to do. And we have to be humble and say, I don't get it. I want to. And then the Lord takes us by the hand and He leads us along. And we, you know, and the scripture is amazing because it says only the childlike will inherit the kingdom. And so that's the whole thing, I think, that's keeping people from that, you know, that important, significant thing, is that they've just got to every day say, I don't get it. You got to help me. We have to be like open books and childlike. And actually, if you go over to What the Lukewarm Church Won't Teach You on Facebook, I actually did, I think it was like the fourth YouTube in a series of six, third or fourth, I talk about childlike faith. And I was so amazing when I had this, you know, light bulb moment that Jesus Himself lowered Himself, humbled Himself to become a child and to be parented by His own creation, which is like phenomenal. The idea that God would be parented by His own creation. I mean, we don't ever really wrap our reins around that, but that's exactly what happened. And if Jesus can humble Himself to become a child on our behalf, which, by the way, he didn't have to do that. He came to earth and did that for us. Then who are we to think that we cannot humble ourselves like children to take direction from God and the Holy Spirit? You see what I mean? It's just so amazing. So there's
Amen.
Hope for all of us.
There is hope for all of us. And, you know, there's different approaches. There's different ways. There's different ways people preach it and teach it.
There's different ways.
David Wilkerson would – one of the things David Wilkerson would say is that – and I have a copy of his preaching on this where he's, you know, going off, you know, and he used to be a great preacher. And he would say – one of the things he would say is that, you know, the root – essentially the root cause of all – problems in the church is that we don't fear God, and that and he's and that only the Holy Spirit can reveal the fear of God to an individual. Now, and that may be true. I kind of agree with that. I think that there's maybe a little bit, you know, a little bit of more Paul Harvey there, a little more, you know, more to the story, right? But yeah, we don't have foundations. You know, we all you do a word study of the word fear. forget about the Old Testament for just a second. Just stay focused on the New Testament, just for this exercise. Do a word study on the word fear. It will blow your mind.
Mm-hmm.
They feared. And you know what? When somebody comes, I hear this all the time. People will say, well, it's a river in fear. And I'm like, baloney it is. It is genuine, blood-curdling, mm-hmm. horrified fear. Well, then, you know, how can God love me? No, you don't understand. God is love. God is judgment. God is wrath.
Mm-hmm.
God is everything.
Right.
He is all the above.
Right.
He's not just love. He's all the above. And the problem is we're conditioned by this fallen world. And the distortion of the devil, especially over the last 100 years, to believe that we have a disciplinarian, strict father who means business that also at the same time loves us.
That's right.
And you know what I'm saying? And I love the Lord. I was blessed, thank you, Jesus, with a father who I feared. I mean, an earthly father who, when it was time for me to get, you know, my chastening, you know, get taken out behind the barn, I screamed. I was like, no, no, please, 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 no.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Because I knew when that hammer came down on my, you know, I was going to be in incredible pain. And the point here is that when my – it's not that I didn't love my mother. I did. But what's fascinating is that even though I was kind of closer to my mom in – the more like chit-chatty, you know, son, you know, but my dad, when my dad passed away, I cannot explain how I cried heaves of tears because there is a desperate connection that one develops in a hard-to-explain love connection that one develops with somebody who they have trusted and learned to trust throughout their life with that heavy hand to make absolutely sure that they aren't going to drive off the guardrail. And my father went an extra mile throughout my entire life at the pain of my rear end to make sure I was not going to drive my car off the guardrail. And when I lost that connection, when he passed, I felt desperately alone. And that, I think, is, you know, when we understand, when Jesus said, pluck your eye out, you know, lest you get cast into hell.
Mm-hmm.
Fear, you don't fear God.
Right.
Cast into hell. He's talking about, you know,
where
the devil and the demons are and where you burn for all of eternity. He's not, Jesus isn't, those aren't euphemisms. Jesus is telling us the way it is. When we are told to fear God, we are told to fear hellfire, burning in all of eternity. So we need to understand that the wages of sin are death and permanent, eternal hell. Okay? So now, when we get that foundation down, everything changes. Now we have the appropriate motivation to understand that there is a penalty. This drives me crazy. There are wonderful preachers and teachers out there that tell people, well, when Jesus died on the cross, it was tetelestai. It was, you know, it was finished. And now, you know, Jesus paid the price for our sin and you know, and all this. And I'm like, what are you doing? What are you telling people it's okay to sin? Because you're reading the same Bible I'm reading.
I know. I'm with you.
Scary.
I'd like to jump in real quick and tell you I did a study on fear myself, and the Lord revealed to me the three main types of fear, John. And here they are. Fear of the devil. And we know that the people who are fearful will be cast into hell. So people who fear the devil. And there's fear of the devil, and that's about torment. There's a second fear, and that's fear of God, who is a God of wrath. He's the God that controls your breath. And so we should fear him because he literally controls your next breath. That's, you got to think about that. And then the third kind of fear is the fear of losing God for eternity, being separated from God for eternity. So fear of God as a God of wrath and punishment and judgment, righteous judgment, and also fear of being separated from God for eternity, fear of being apart from goodness for all time. And that's a different form of fear, but it's also like, wow, you know, that's frightening that we should separate ourselves from all that is good for eternity. And so the Lord went on to show me that if we fear the devil, now this is going to blow your mind. Fearing the devil is a form of worship of the devil. So basically we're giving him power over us. And so when we move our fear over to God, which is the beginning of understanding, we move our worship from the devil over to the Lord, and the devil does not have control over us anymore. It is God who has control over us. And we do not fear him because we fear God, the one who protects us. And we have a healthy fear of God because, oh, by the way, we should be fearing him. And so this is like phenomenal because this is the thing that the devil does not want you to figure out, because that moves you into the category of overcomer. And he's all about bells and whistles and, you know, snake oil salesmen, smoke and mirrors. But you see, God is really the one to be feared. And so when we move into fear of God and take our fear of the devil and put it all over into God's category, then he cannot have his way with us, torment us and all these things, although he'll try. And
I would submit it's even the turning point. I don't recall fearing the devil ever in my life, praise Jesus. But that's because I was born and raised in a spiritual warfare, kicked the demons and devils, you know, out of the houses, poltergeist slamming doors, that kind of stuff. You know, my parents, I'm serious. I'm talking about my family and the people we hung out with were house cleaners. We would go into houses that had poltergeist slamming doors, hot to pans, kick them out of there. But the turning point is when you – when you understand the power that you have, not only do you not fear the devil, but you're angry at him and you're angry at his demons, and you set aside special time to go kick them out. You know, because we are the sons of God, the masters of the devil and the demons, and the foot washers of mankind. And when we assume that role of authority through the power of Christ, it becomes a real in the devil's flesh, as it were. and I got to share, in the spirit of the fear of God thing, this is just awesome. This is from Oswald Chambers, and his quote is, I love this, "The remarkable thing about fearing God is that when you fear God, you fear nothing else. Whereas if you do not fear God, you fear
perfect
everything
love.
Else. You know?
Yeah, perfect praise love casts
anyway,
out fear. Wow.
I got to give you the 5 minutes to share with people where can they find more information, your website, your main Facebook page, so people can get in touch, and also close with a prayer for us tonight.
Okay. Right. Well, we're all over Facebook, as I mentioned before. You can find me on Susan Davis Facebook. If you enter into the search engine, Marriage Supper of the Lamb, .wix.endtimes, we have a end times catalog with a lot of our materials there free, all of the books that I had put out, and many other anointed writers who have provided their books free. You know, you won't see PayPal on our catalog. We give it all away free. And we just want people to read, and we have many, like I said, many anointed writers that have various topics that they have lent their books and materials to our catalog free, and we're ministry partners with them as well, and we know them, and so we trust their materials, and the Holy Spirit had brought these people to us, and anyway, all of this is available free at that Marriage Supper of the Lamb.wix dot end times, or Marriage Supper of the Lamb, Susan Davis. You can put that in any search engine, and we usually pop up at some point. But the email is K-I-D like dog, S like Sam, M like Mary, K, T like Tom, G like Gary, and then at sbcglobal.net. Anybody can write me anytime they want for any of our, you know, information. We got a ton of stuff. We have a lot of end time stuff that we have put together to help people use as tools to reach other people. That's what we like to do, is we like to provide materials to help people, to show people that we are in fact in the end times. And so we have a lot of stuff people can utilize, and things, we're developing more things every day, like 50 scriptures that have prophecies that have come to pass that show we're in the end times. We have all these kinds of things. And so, you know, we're just out there just trying to see how many people we can assist the Lord get off this rock before it's too late. That's how, you know, we're trying to utilize every ounce of energy that we can in these last days.
Well said, because you know what? If we don't get people to understand where we are in the end times timeline, they will slip into a state of complacency and they will go back to life as usual. And that will be inadequate to make the rapture. And that's what counts, is getting out of here before it's too late. Praise Jesus. And would you close with a prayer for us tonight? God bless you. What a powerful program. God bless you. Thank you. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Okay.
Go ahead and close with prayer.
Dear Lord, thank you so much for this opportunity to come before you and to reveal yourself to everyone. And Lord, right now I just pray that they would make you their Lord and Master, that they would ask to have a full oil lamp, a filling of your Holy Spirit, and that they would remove their will and put it into the will of the Father, so that they can have the perfect plan for their life and that they can walk with the Lord. And Lord, I just pray that they would become intimate friends with the Lord, that they would talk to him all through the day and know him as a God who is alive and well and real and who can be trusted to watch over them in these very dark and difficult hours. No one has to live in fear if they walk closely with the Lord. I just pray that all these things will come to the people. And in Jesus' name, amen.
Praise God. Amen and amen. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Powerful, powerful show, Sister Susan. Susan Davis, praise God. And folks, again, just go to Facebook.com and type in the search bar, End Time Landslides, End Time Sinkholes, End Times News Reports, End Times Blood Rivers, End Time Signs in the Sky. This is a great way to wake people up. Praise Jesus. What a powerful message. Thank you so much for joining us tonight, Susan. God bless you.
Amen. God bless.
See y'all this Friday night at 7 p.m. for the prayer vigil and communion service, Lord willing. See y'all.